this. Oh, I've already fucked up the intro.
Now
Excellent.
nah, we're keeping that in. We're keeping that in. Let's just keep going. Keep going.
Welcome to the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. I am back. This is the 3rd year anniversary episode, I think. Yeah, started 2020. Here we are, 2023. 3 years of the SWN podcast, and we're back. I have joined on this edition for the fourth time. The most viewed interview on the SWN podcast. I think you've got like two of the top five spots. I'm joined by the one and only YouTube megastar, Alex Webb. Welcome to the
Oh.
show.
Just Alex Webb is fine. No, I took it personally the last time I was here because you said I wasn't the top viewed podcast, and I was like, that can't be happening. So I went on my community tab, said, "Hey boys, can you give us a few? Give us a couple of views," and here I am now.
They delivered. Yeah, so you're to the top. You took top three. You're both Angel Haze is in the middle, so it's an Angel Haze sandwich.
I'll take that. I'll take
Yeah,
wait.
love
I'll take
that.
that.
The ITV Celebrity Wrestling Rise and Fall is still just ahead of you, though. But
That's
that's
good.
outside of the SWN podcast itself. But I mean, we've already had a chat outside of this, but this is for the actual canon of the podcast. How's it going?
Going pretty good. I just wrestled for Discovery not that long ago, like as of recording this 2 days ago. But Spider-Verse is out. I haven't seen it yet. I'm going to be seeing it soon. So life's pretty good. Life's pretty good.
I haven't seen it either, and I'm just looking, keep looking at times, going, oh, can I just sneak out after work and just I can't like can deal with the baby for a couple of hours.
I was about to say,
I'll go see
life's
Spider-Man.
different when you've got responsibilities.
I know the amount of organizing what to do to go see Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3, which we will speak about, was just it was a mission in itself, and
Oh.
just one of those things you've got to deal with now as a grown up, I suppose. You got to kind of go, oh, you have to miss out on some fun things for
I have
fun
a
things.
cat, but it's not. I have a cat, but he can just take care of himself most of the time.
Exactly. Like our dog, she's fine for like 5 hours. That's fine. Well, that's plenty of time to go and watch a film, but I think he might struggle. I
Yeah, baby's a little bit different.
mean, he goes down at 7 for and that's him for the night. So no, anyway, right. This is not gonna end well for me, and I'll probably end up getting a message
Kelly will
from
be
someone.
watching this back, being like,
I'm safe. She doesn't watch them.
Oh,
That's
great.
fine. She supports. She's fine with me doing them, but she's like, I'm not watching them, so I'll go to the shows with you. That's it.
My girlfriend's like that with my YouTube videos. Like he says, I fucking hate him, but you're really good at doing them and you're doing well, so it's so good. I don't think you're funny though, and I'm like, oh, cheers.
She's not one of your 13.6 million viewers.
13.6.
That's
No,
what take a
I don't
spot, I think.
believe so.
And
It's the subtotal is I believe it's like 140,000 at the moment. So
that's your subs, of course. But yeah, your viewership is. I was looking at going up. I better get some facts and notes on that because last time we spoke was December, so there's not a huge
yeah,
amount of
okay,
rest
no,
content.
fair enough. Yeah, no, the views are pretty much like I think the last video I did pretty well because I got about 25,000 in 10 hours, give or take, which is pretty good for me. I think on average, my videos this year have roughly done between like 150K, I'd say like 200K, and then I did a video on Morbius, which you absolutely adore and told me to do, obviously, Billy.
Oh, God.
But I did a video like it was a retrospective. I don't know if you ever watched like Internet Historian or any channels like that, but they do like kind of retrospectives on like different things. Like he did No Man's Sky and did like a whole like hour long video on No Man's Sky and how that went from a disaster to a really good game. So I was like, fuck it, I could do the same thing on Morbius. It's in my realms of interest. Morbius isn't, Spider-Man is. So I thought I knew a lot about it. So I figured I could probably do a good bit of research into it and then do the video. And I was like, I put it out and didn't do that well for me to begin with. And I was like, oh, okay, it's a video on Morbius. What to expect? And now it's like, I think in the out of my past like five videos, it's the best performing with like 500K. So I can't really complain.
Just got to build up it because I mean obviously it's not morbid time all the time. It's
No, it's not.
got to be a specific time, and
Unfortunately.
oh, I still have nightmares about that film. and it just
Bro, I had to watch it. I had to watch it 3 times, and I also had to edit it, so that meant I had to go back and watch the film multiple times. So, yeah, it wasn't a great time for me either.
I that's dedication to the craft. That
Thank you.
is, I wouldn't watch it again. I haven't finished Black Adam. I started watching Black Adam, and then eventually I was like, I have no idea what's happening. And
I've just All I've heard about is The Rock's refusal to put anyone over within the film, so.
that's what it is. It's like I put one tweet just going, The Rock must have just, well, I put it in a PC term, but he must have had a hard on when he was doing it, because it's just The Rock being cool for, well, I only got
Yeah.
an hour and a half in. I thought, I can't be arsed anymore. This is just shit.
I think in terms of like wrestlers turned actors, the list goes Batista, John Cena, The Rock. Like, I like Dwayne, but he plays the same fucking character every single time he's in a film. It's the same, just like there's a meme going around where it's a picture of him from like 4 different films, and it just looks like the same character every single time.
I mean, he started off well because he was just trying to do any film he could. So, I mean, I hated Tooth Fairy, but you know, it was different. It was something. It was a Disney film. It was nice, and then he did things like
Yeah.
Get Shorty. Was it Get Shorty? Get Smart. That's what it was. Get Smart. Be
I
cool.
remember he
Be cool.
They
That's what it
not
was called.
do be cool. They not do race. Was it Race to Witch Mountain?
Yes.
Yes, and he also did Game Plan, where he was like a football star and was
Oh,
a
yeah. All
was like the
right.
distant dad, didn't have a relationship with his daughter or anything like that.
You're kind of blowing my initial going, oh, it wasn't that bad, out the water now when you're mentioning those films, because yeah, that was a Gridiron Dad. That was a really bad one as well. Yeah.
I remember him in The Mummy as a lovely CGI scorpion.
Big PS1 graphics.
Oh my God. Fantastic graphics, really.
I was gonna say for the time, but even then it was still pretty bad for
When did it come out? Because I remember
two.
the first Spider-Man had like a short had like pretty iffy CGI, but even then the Mummy Returns, like that CGI on The Rock was something else, man.
2001 it came out.
Oh God.
Like, it's weird though, because you see that CGI. This isn't what this episode's about, but you see the CGI of The Rock in that, and then you go to play Pokemon 2001, which spring it was 2002, wasn't it? So SmackDown 2, and even then you look at SmackDown 2 and think that's not great in comparison, but you know,
Yeah.
it's not far off.
I'd like the preference. Before this episode began, Billy said, "Oh, how are we going to structure this?" And I was like, "We'll just do the usual. We'll do wrestling, and then we'll go into the films if you want." And now we spent the first 5 minutes chatting about The Rock's acting career. So
Well,
anything's up in the air now.
he's going to be back in the Fast films, apparently. I don't know. Haven't watched one since Fast Five, so
I have not seen any of the Fast and Furious films, and I really don't plan on watching it.
is that on your list of things? Maybe if you're literally run out of anything to speak about and make a video on, you'll just start going
I
through the Fast
mean,
films.
kind of it is. I'd rather just do stuff that I've got like a big interest in. It's I mean, Morbius I don't have a big interest in, but again, Spider-Man, so I can like feign an interest. But with like Fast and Furious, I'm not a cars guy, so like I never really was into the first couple ones, and then I never really got into the other ones, especially with Vin Diesel just being like family, family. That's all his dialogue. Like if you look at the script, it just said Vin Diesel says family and then ad lib. That's all he does. Like.
I mean, technically, it's based, but I mean, he's probably got more words in the Guardians films as well, because you know, he's got
Probably
Wee
got a more nuanced
R.
character as well.
Yeah, there is that. He's a bit delusional now, as Vin Diesel, when you see him get in interview thinking the Fast X of the Fast and Furious franchise is like the most amazing franchise and most diverse franchise in the world. And you go, no, what trees have you been smoking?
I suppose though, with any like actor or anyone that's so involved in their own like franchise, they're gonna have to big it up because no one fucking else is like.
I just imagine I'm going to the red carpet going, oh, Ben, what did you think of this film? It's a bit shit, to be honest, but the next one should be pretty good. You know, we'll take it 50-50.
I can just imagine him like sending in Fast X for an Oscar nomination, like for your consideration.
Oh, absolutely. If it's not that, you'll dust off Riddick or something and just and be
Oh,
done.
do not remind me of Riddick. Oh, was that he did Blood? Was it Bloodshot? Or like he did like a comic book film recently where he was just like say recently, it was probably like 5 years ago. But he did like a comic book film where he's like made up a little like nanobots or some pish like that, and he's like can shoot his like arms and stuff. I don't know. It's Vin Diesel. Any films, it's the same thing. I could be talking about Fast X for all I know.
We talk about the pacifier for all I remember as well. So who knows? Yeah. So you mentioned Batista. So we are going to speak about him a good bit in this because this episode is called Guardians of the Galaxy because I finally thought of a good pun name that hopefully your community won't rip apart and think of a better one for me. And then I'm going to look at it and go, I fucking hate this because of after Spider after what was it, Webverse, which should have been Spider Web.
I always get a lot of comments where it's like a lot of people end up thinking of better like ways to summarize what I'm saying. So like I remember like years ago I got a comment on like one of my WWE 2K20 videos, and it was like someone pretty much put in a full length review in the comments. And then I read it and was like, this is more articulate and better structured than my entire video. So I just pinned it and said, read this, please, to anyone that was looking at the comments just to like get a better analysis of the game.
It's not even that happens. You think you spend all that time and then you just go, and then someone just comes in and goes, yeah, this, and you go, Jesus, that was just way better. But this episode was spawned initially because I did a live episode just in my living room because I was bored and I didn't and everyone was out of the house, so you know naturally you get the camera out and you go on live on Facebook. So that's the first thing you do, and you commented saying that you wanted to be on speaking about Guardians. I said Guardians of the Galaxy. There we go. That was it. That's pretty much the definition of how this came to be. After the success of previous film-based episodes, like the one we did with Spider-Man, and also Ian Skinner's one where we talked about Austin Powers Gold Member, which was did not it was not the episode I thought it was going to be because I thought we would just dick about for like an hour and a half, but he came in with notes, and
Oh, did he?
oh yeah, he
Oh,
watched the film again and had notes and everything in the first,
really?
yeah. So I couldn't believe it because I didn't watch it. I just
I would have thought Skinner would have just bullshit for the entire podcast. Like, knowing him, I would have thought he would just have, like, rambled about. I honestly would have thought he would have came in and talked about Flubber for, like, an hour and a half and not even mention Austin Powers. But fair enough.
Well, I mean, I did come to I said, right, okay, this is gonna be funny. We'll say we're gonna do this, and then we'll spend an hour speaking about anything but, and then get to the end and go run out of time, and then we'll move on. But no,
Oh,
it's, but he
okay.
watched it again. And he went, no, I really need, I won't speak about this. I won't speak about all of this. So okay, shit. Okay, I'll Wikipedia. I'll get the Wikipedia thing up just so I've got the plot in front of me.
I think
But.
I just, anytime Skinner speaks about anything he's remotely interested in, I always go back to the meme of Charlie Day just like at the whiteboard from Always Sunny. Just
Very much a Pepe Silva vibe from
yeah, pretty much.
So about you though, you're doing quite well in the wrestling. Oh, actually, I was saying quite well. Like last time I saw you wrestle, you lost your tag team titles.
Listen. I've seen Ryan comment on the post as well.
Yeah.
Ugh, disgusting.
It was quite a sh it was an amazing show. It was weird though because it seems to be like out of just about every match, someone came out with an injury. So I don't know if your match, you guys were fairly in one piece afterwards, but
The
it was
ring
quite weird.
wasn't.
Of course.
I
Of course.
didn't know this happened. So for the. For anyone not understanding, it was a match at Aberdeen Anarchy with the Saints, myself and Steven wrestling the Foundation of Future for the tag titles in the 2 out of 3 falls match. The first fall went to the Foundation. They rolled up Steven with a quick fall. Second fall went to us with Steven hitting a 450, and then the third fall went back to the Foundation when they murdered me with power bombs, a brain buster, and then an assisted pile driver. So great day for us all around. But then I came back and everyone was fine. Everyone was all good. And then and then someone just says the ring's broke. And I was like, "What do you mean?" Apparently, we had broken the ring. I had no fucking clue about it. I'm obviously the lightest guy in the match, so I was like, "Was it me, boys?" As I like slowly like sliver away.
I forgot about that because yeah, they announced it just as the next match, and then afterwards it was right. We're taking an interval. I was like, usually same main event, first half main event. That's a bit weird. I thought the ladder match would be made, and then I saw them starting to try and saw someone go under the ring, the magician, the one that has the fedora, go underneath the ring and start
I think
kicking.
it was I think it was like from the way I remember it, our tag match was like the first half main, and then the opener was the ladder match for the second half. So it worked out, I suppose. But yeah, I didn't even know we had broken the ring. I was talking to Lou about this, and he was like, "Yeah, like the board has moved off." And I was like, "Oh, fantastic!" And then apparently at disco we did the same thing, and I was like, "Stephen, we need to watch what we're doing, lad."
You're the grown up here. You're responsible for the ring, Stephen. You just make sure we don't break.
I mean, I'm 25 now. I'm getting a bit too old to use the excuse that Stephen's the grown up here. I should know better too.
I mean, you say that I'm 32 and I still look for an adult. If something goes wrong, I'm just like I am not equipped for this. I need to find someone at least 35 and above. That's grown up age, right? That
That's
makes sense.
that's the benchmark. And then when you hit that age, you'll be 40s. 40s are
40,
grown up
absolutely,
now.
yeah. Right up to five. That's the next level. Even then, if someone
Forever.
come 25, if you came to me for advice, I'd be like, I am not equipped for this. So find someone older. You're gonna have to move up. There you go. 10 years. If you're under 30, it's 10 years. 30, it's five. That's the scale of it.
That's the benchmarks.
It is. So since then, so we last spoke December. It was just before, I think it was just before Christmas Chaos. No, it was
It was afterwards.
just after, yeah, because I was all giddy because, of course, Aspen won, and
Aspen, yes, he did.
we spoke about that for a very long time, and then we started speaking about you win titles or something like that. I don't know, and then I just insulted you, your hair,
My hairline, yeah. Cheers for that, Billy. I
and
appreciate it.
and that's okay. I shaved my head just in solidarity for this episode because I thought I can't go in with like. Patches thinking, oh, no, I'm opening myself up to be ridiculed in return. But I don't know. We got a sponsorship out of it for I don't know
From
who.
what, Manscaped?
Oh yeah, but I got a thing for
I was
Manscaped.
about to say,
Yeah.
I haven't had anything for myself. I haven't keeps or anything in a while. I was asking my rep, like, can I get like a hair care product, just to maintain it for a little bit longer. No, I was. I think I'm all good with like the hair comments, as you obviously know. It's I take the piss out of it myself, but I'm noticing more now. Obviously, last time we were here, we spoke about how I put up that picture of me with my plaque and the tag belt, and the top comment of it was just male pattern baldness. I'm now noticing in a lot of my videos now, there's just odd comments being like, "Oh, this video made my hairline go forward by like 5 inches," and I'm like, "Does that mean it's good? Does that like, or like someone's commented saying, here, I've heard a secret. If you upload more often, your hairline will grow back." And I'm like, "Cheers, boys. Cheers." I'm just kidding. Like my own community is just now like slewing me consistently.
I mean, it could be worse, but when I was doing the graphics for the Day of Birth Bonanza, oh, by the way, it'll be announced by this point, but you are in the Day of Birth
Oh,
Bonanza.
I am,
Just,
yes.
I looked through pictures, looking for promo pictures so I could put it on the graphic, and I picked one that was a David J. Wilson, an official one, so it should be fairly safe. You look very,
Okay.
like, it's the one where you're like that. You'll see
Oh,
it.
my
Wait,
holding
sorry.
the invisible baguette.
Yes, that's the one. But
The invisible baguette, yes.
I did have the one with you with the YouTube plaque for a bit because I thought that'd be quite funny. Everyone's like looking a professional and you've got a YouTube plaque, but I remember that was the picture that got commented male pattern baldness. I didn't know you
Thing is,
could
I don't think my hairline looks that bad in that picture. So I'm like, I don't know where it came from, but fair enough.
I think it's the angle. It's because I don't think I look that big. And then Kelly, because she's like a foot shorter than me, takes a picture of me. It's going up the way. So
Oh,
I look like a monster in comparison,
don't
so I think
say that about
it's
yourself, Billy. Come on now.
just angles.
Kind,
That's
be
all it is.
kind. No, I think that's probably the case. Just I think also I had just wrestled not that long ago, so sweaty as well, so fair enough.
Yeah, that'll be it. So you had a match with Foundation with Ronan Murphy,
Yes,
in
that was a weird
January.
one.
That was like that whole show was odd because of course there was changes to the card and. Seemed to be all the changes that were made, though, made the show even better, which was amazing. And you
I
got
heard I didn't get a chance to see it, but I heard Connor and Caleb in an absolute banger, so I was very happy for them, but at the same time I was like, fuck, we've got to follow that now.
I know, and you got in with Murphy and who Murphy's about Murphy, Murphy, Murphy.
Because I thought we were it was obviously going to be us versus the outfit. So when me and Stephen did a promo, it was us at the in Prague Fashion Week, just like or Milan Fashion Week, just planning for the outfit and just usual pitch that I do in the promos, which has now just turned into Stephen going, "I'll say something, you edit around me." I'm like, "No worries, Stephen, I'll do that." But yeah, no, and obviously we got told it was Ronan. I was like, "Oh, I really want to work with Ronan," but I didn't know how. I didn't know how it was going to mesh with obviously Murphy's got a very different character in comparison to Ronan, but and Ronan already had a match to that show, and I was like, oh boy! And then that show just ended up being the Ronan King show, so to inflate the boy's ego even more.
I know it's a damn shame he's not good at the wrestling. He said it himself that he wasn't the best wrestler in the world.
I know, I have that saved in my phone too. Don't worry.
I think everyone in WrestleZone has at this point, just in case he needs to be humbled a little bit.
Although he, so one more thing on that, there was a bit where I think he threw me out the ring, and then said, "And I'm normally quite good to pull the curtain back. I'm normally quite good at not corpsing during matches." But he just said something where it was like, "Your YouTube subscribers aren't going to save you now." I just, fuck. I had to like cover a Jey Uso moment. I had to like cover my face as I walked along.
Oh,
I was like, that one caught me off guard.
he's just excellent, and it's just disgusting being
Yes,
19
let's
not.
not say it any. Let's not say it anymore because he will clip this and use it against us forever.
Absolutely. That led to Regal Rumble, of course, and you spent most of the match getting battered because Miles did an amazing backflip courtesy of a Ryan Riley clothesline right at the start of the match, which
He did.
that was
I think that I think out of everything in that match, that'll be the thing that gets remembered the most because it was a brutal way to start the match. And it was like I think the thing I really like about our matches, especially like with the foundations, regardless of where it is, where it's WrestleZone, FCW, Disco, anywhere it's always been different. And I think that the way that match started was a great way to get the crowd going. Holy shit! This man's dad's just been murdered, and now he's getting murdered in the ring. Yeah, because then I obviously that was me fighting back the entire match, and Steven like tried to get his like to get his bearings again. I should really be saying Miles because he doesn't like being called Stephen Air Miles, so I really should be saying Miles. But in promos where it's like, "Oh yeah, Air," I'm not calling you Air. Hey, come on now. But yeah, no, but like Stephen's like obviously trying to get his bearings throughout the majority of the match, and then it's me like throwing Stephen, and then he's trying to get up, and then Ryan keeps on bashing out, and the crowds want it, and then more, and then I eventually get to him, and he comes in, and it works really well, and then we did a. So like sequences of like tag moves upon tag moves, and I think we really got the crowd to bite when they hit me with the assisted pile driver and Steven like last minute got him come off. So no, I think Regal Rumble like I really enjoyed, and then I think Anarchy is probably my favorite match with Foundation, despite the
Yeah.
outcome, obviously.
Oh, yeah, of course. But no, it's been you've had quite a packed 6 months, of course, because yeah, you had the stuff at WrestleZone and you'd had a bit of at Fair City as well. So
Yeah.
it's been a good old time. Were
It's a
you?
packed couple of months, but I'm only wrestling Foundation. I'm like
Yeah.
is either a combination of is Ryan's the consistent. Is either Ryan or Brad or Ryan and Zach? And I'm like, oh boys, it's the same people I'm fighting all the time, and I love it.
And were you at ringside during the Rumble when Miles died? Or was I think it was definitely Miles was, because I remember his face.
Miles definitely was. I was in the back because they were like, "Alex, we can't have you going out because you'll blow your knee out again. We can't be having that. You're a tag champ now." But no, so I wasn't coming until later, and then I just seen. So I knew the Canadian was happening, and I was like, I want to see how everyone reacts to that. And then I didn't know the murder was about to happen though. And I mean, and most of the times you don't know when a murder is about to happen. Let's be honest here. Then, so I knew Malice has like a tendency to take nasty bumps at Rumble shows, especially from Caleb. I seen him get murdered. Was it the 2019 one where he just gets dumped to the floor?
Yeah, that was
Yeah.
incredible.
I think in 2022 he got off lightly, and then Caleb was like, "Oh fuck you, you're dying this time," but. I assumed that there'd be people there to catch him as he gets thrown over the top rope. It was a deadly driver to the floor, but I'd assumed there'd be people there to catch him. Partly not.
Well, to pull back the curtain a little bit, because I'd ask if he was still alive after the show, I was told that he was supposed to call the signal, and he didn't.
Yeah, from what I'm aware, he was supposed to tell people, like, because Caleb was like, "Please tell people that you're doing this, because I don't want to just throw you to the floor." As lovely a gentleman Caleb is, and then people just didn't tell anyone. So I remember Stephen coming back, and he just went to me, Mr. Wrestlezone just came up to me and said, "Go catch him." And Stephen was like, "What do you mean?" And then just the second you just see it's like a fucking plane. It's just going down.
It was just amazing. I don't know how that man is still. He's not. He's a ghost. That's just it. He's not a living, breathing thing anymore. He's just Mr. Malice, the man who just dies at shows. Anything else we want to speak about wrestling before we dive in? I think we've kind of covered everything.
Not particularly. I don't really have anything to mention at the moment. Obviously, we've talked about WrestleZone losing tag belts. Fuck you, Foundation. FCW, obviously wrestling there a little bit more, enjoying it there too. Briscoe just in the match against the Woke Academy, enjoyed that as well. So yeah, we're doing pretty good.
Cool, right. That's the wrestling portion of the podcast done. So if anyone wants to listen to us speak about films, keep listening. We've got loads of questions as well, so we'll get to them
All
as
the
we're
way.
kind of breaking up the episodes.
I
The
thought
film.
considering this was like my fourth time on this, there would be like no questions because everyone's already asked their questions.
I know, and I thought that as well, but I got a good few about Guardians itself, so it kind of works out in our favor
Fair
because
enough.
about the actual film that we're going for, except we'll start with Ryan's because you already mentioned that he did put a message in. Put as always, hi Billy, hope you're well. Thank you. Not a question, but a statement. Forever the Foundation. There we go. There's that.
I'm just saying, we've had six matches and we're three apiece. So, we're tying at the moment, boys. Come on now.
There you go. That's it. That's the need the rubber match. Oh, before we actually get to the actual meat of this episode, you also won two prestigious awards. You were, of course, the one to watch tag team of the year, and oh, wonderful, and
We're up
podcast of
next
the
to the
year.
plaque. We're up next to
That warms
the
my heart.
plaque.
Yes, you are the winners, the recipients of two awards, on the Aberdeen Wankathon edition of the SWN Year End Awards. So, I'm glad that you've displayed them in pride of place, and I'm not offended if you, when we stop recording, you just put them back into a drawer. Just
Really, they've been there since you gave them to me. I haven't just done this for the
That's I'll believe you. Right. So yes, meat and potatoes of this podcast. So well, that's not my notes. Here they are. Guardians of the Galaxy. So that's what we're gonna kinda try and fit in the next
Yes.
however long we've got. Way back when, July 2014, the first film came out. I of course you were must have been in school, I'm guessing. As
2014, did you say?
twenty fourteen.
I would have been 16.
That's yep. So yeah, I was probably your age now. Yeah, I would have been around by then. So yeah,
Don't really,
2014.
we're like near enough 10 years apart, so.
Yeah, oh, I know my knees feel it. So yeah, so that was the it was I don't know what entry it was in the actual MCU scope of things, but of course Marvel Cinematic Universe, big thing, still quite big, even though they're a bit more missed than hit at the moment when it comes to the films. This came out, we didn't know anything really about it unless you're a comic book nerd, because Guardians of the Galaxy is a very obscure, at the time, a very obscure franchise in Marvel lore. Oh, sorry, I did write it down. It's the 10th MCU film of the actual ream of things. What were your thoughts? Do you remember what your kind of thoughts going into it? Were you just, it's a Marvel film, I'm going to go see it? Or did you know much about the Guardians of the Galaxy beforehand?
I had no clue about Guardians of the Galaxy beforehand. I think back in like 2014, I wasn't really. I liked superhero films, obviously, big Spider-Man guy, but I wasn't really keeping up to date with the MCU. I didn't really keep up to date with the MCU until like lockdown. So, like, I obviously would watch the odd film here or there, but I never really kept up with it. So, I think with Guardians, I don't. I can't remember how, but I went to watch it with my at the time girlfriend, who's obviously an ex now, but. We went to watch it, and I remember watching it and thinking, oh, this is pretty good, but it's just a, I don't know why, but I remember coming out and being like, oh, it's just a generic space film. And I would like to slap 16-year-old me for thinking that. Because then during lockdown, I went back and rewatched a lot of the MCU, all of the MCU pretty much in like chronological order. Because during lockdown, as we all know, there was fuck all to do. So I had ran out of watching Breaking Bad and Mr. Robot. So I was like, you know what, I'll look for something different. I went over to Disney Plus, and I was like, the only things there were either The Simpsons or The Walking Dead. And am I fuck watching 10 or 11 seasons of The Walking Dead, where it's we gotta go to a different city, guys. There's walkers all around us. At the moment, I'm currently rewatching season one with my girlfriend. So I now have a different appreciation for it. But at the time, I was not fucking sitting watching 10 seasons of The Walking Dead. And I was not sitting watching 30 seasons of The Simpsons. Although, in saying that, obviously the first like nine or so seasons of The Simpsons are really good, but the more they get, the more humor. Yeah, nah, I'm good. Anyway, so I then went to the MCU, and I was like, fuck it, I'll watch the first Iron Man. And then it just kind of spewed from there. And I remember watching and thinking Iron Man was really good. Iron Man 2, it's not. Four was pretty mediocre, and the more you go through them, the more like, obviously I don't like watching stuff with a super critical brain, but you're going to like be like, oh, like this is bad, this is good, blah blah blah. And then I got to Guardians. I like blew my mind because it was so different, unique, and I didn't have any expectations of who these characters should be. So I think that's why the film could have just been anything. And I had that kind of James Gunn flair where it was like the jokes work exceptionally well for those characters and it fit the tone of that film. Obviously, I did a video on this like a little bit ago where you nearly threatened to cancel this podcast over it. But I did a video talking about the ramifications of Guardians of the Galaxy, and more specifically the comedy that they inject into the film, because it really kind of set the MCU on this path to have every film needs a fucking joke every 5 minutes. And Guardians in itself really worked with that comedy, and it's a brilliant fucking film. But it's kind of the patient zero for infecting the rest of the MCU with this style of comedy where it really doesn't work. But in terms of Guardians, fantastic film upon rewatching it again, and it quickly became like my favorite MCU film. Yeah, I don't know if you want to get into specifics about the film, but that's my overview.
We've got a lot of films to kind of to go, so we won't like go, this is how it started, blah blah blah, but maybe just pick out some bits, memorable bits. But for me, this was the first movie that I went to with my now wife. We went to go see it. It came out June, July 2014, so we started going out June 2014, so it was the first cinema date
Oh,
we
really?
had. Yeah, we
Oh,
went
that's cute.
to, and she had never went to a Marvel film beforehand, so what she told me she did when I said, oh, I'm gonna go see Guardians of the Galaxy, do you want to come? By text, leave one kiss at the end because that's the kind of romantic I am. She
Ah, true romance.
she went to her pals, her friend's house, and went, yeah, I haven't watched any of these films. So she her friend had most of the DVDs, so she watched like as many as she could beforehand.
You
And
picked like the best possible film to watch with someone that hadn't seen, if she'd still not seen any of them. You don't need to watch any of the other source material to watch Guardians. It's, or at least the first two anyway. So she didn't need to any of the backstory, which is so good. Like, one of the other reasons why I love the Guardians, you don't need to do all the homework to understand the themes of the film.
That's it. I mean, it gets a bit weird now in the obviously the most recent film. You do need a little bit of context, but the kind of a little bit is provided, but not all the whole story,
Yeah.
kind of thing. But that's like four things away for us to speak about. But yeah, so Guardians 1, I love this film just because you're right. You came with no expectations. You kind of expected, oh, it's an MCU film, so there might be a few jokes here or there. But like you're saying, they hit every kind of joke. And I watched them again very recently, just for this particular episode, and I was blown away. But not just because of every joke landing and it being just an amazing film, but also the music. I forgot how great the music was as well.
Yeah.
It fit the tone of the moments as well. It just made you appreciate going back to watch things like the first Scooby-Doo film that James Gunn did as well. You go,
Yeah.
he's pretty good at this filmmaking stuff, as James Gunn.
He's so fucking good at it. He did a horror film beforehand. I think it's like called, is it called Sliver or something like that?
That sounds familiar, yeah.
Yeah, he did a horror film before that, and then he did a film called Super with the White from The Office and Elliot Page. And it's a really like fucked up version of like this random guy who just becomes a superhero. I haven't watched it in ages, so I could be slaughtering the plot here. But this random guy just becomes like decides to be a superhero, and it like shows the gruesome details of what that means, of how that may go. As a it's a good film. I haven't seen it in ages. I might actually watch it after this podcast. Not do work, which I probably should do. But yeah, and then he did Guardians, and I think just it really meshed well with him because I think because no one had really had any expectations of Guardians and like Star Lord, no one really knew what to do with them. I think James Gunn came in and had this vision that he wanted to do with the Guardians and take these like really obscure misfit characters and make them into a proper family, which is ironic considering Vin Diesel is a tree in it.
There you go. It's, it all connects after our Fast and Furious chat as well.
It does, but yeah, no, it just it works so well, and the themes of like because obviously a lot of it is about like Rocket is an abused little raccoon who hates everyone because and obviously we'll get into this when we talk about the third film, but he hates everyone because he was made in the lab, and as he says, he was like ripped apart and put back together again over and over and over again, and like because he obviously has lost people. He doesn't want to open himself up to other people, and he finds Groot, and that's his only friend. But I think with Groot obviously protects Rocket a lot of the time, and Groot's like a fucking saint in comparison to all the other Guardians. In terms of Rocket, he doesn't want to open himself up to other people, and I think the more throughout the film he does, and then Drax obviously has lost his family. Gamora is running from an abusive household. Peter Quill is constantly running from the responsibilities of dealing with the fucking trauma that he's dealt from like his mum dying. And I think that all comes together at the end of the film where Peter grabs the Power Stone, I want to say.
Yep, I understood.
Yep, Power Stone. And he's holding it, and he obviously holding it is killing him. And then Gamora like grabs him, and he holds his hand, and it flashes back to Peter like accepting to grab his mum's hand, and like why he grabbed his hand, and then Drax holds on to Peter, and then Rocket holds on to Drax, and it's like, oh, they're all a family, and they're sharing the pain that they all feel from their different trauma, and they're all come together. Just chef kiss. Yes.
Yeah, I don't think there's much more I can really add to that, but yeah, it really is. I think everyone, every character, you had something you could relate to, or at least one of the characters, even if it was the innocence of Groot or the like you said, in the running from trauma of Peter Quill. When it came to casting at all, I mean, for beforehand, for me, I only knew Chris Pratt from Parks and Rec, of course,
Yeah.
Andy Dwyer, and he was a big lad, so. I mean, yeah, I didn't know what to expect from Star Lord in general, so I wasn't expecting to be ripped, but see that difference. And you look at the cast list as well, because of course, you've got Bradley Cooper as Rocket, who does amazingly. It's weird that you don't. It doesn't sound like Bradley Cooper, but there's like a
No,
twinkle
it
in the eye
doesn't.
of Rocket Raccoon that looks like Bradley
Yeah.
Cooper at the same time. Same with Vin Diesel as Groot. It looks a bit like Vin Diesel in the weirdest possible way.
I get what you mean. I get what you mean.
Yeah, it's just something. You look at it and go, "Oh, it's Vin Diesel voice great." You go, "Yeah, okay, yeah, I can see that."
I think in terms of casting, like Chris Pratt for at the time for a superhero film, everyone was just like the fat funny man from Parks and Rec. Like that's all everyone kind of thought, and then he shows up and he's fucking jacked. He's ripped, boy, and he like obviously he's still using his comedic timing from like Parks and Rec. And it works really well for that character, and he can show a lot of depth and emotion. And considering the only really stuff I had seen him do before was that one Kim Kardashian clip that circles every now and again, where it's like everyone loves a comeback story.
So you miss
Kim
it.
Kardashian. Well, no, she has come on her. Oh, lovely, lovely thing to bring up on a podcast. But no, there was that where like he throws like a briefcase
The
and it
briefcase,
like
yeah.
takes a light switch. Those are the clips that I've seen of him. I haven't really watched Parks and Rec, as you can probably tell.
It's not bad.
I
Get don't watch season one. Forget, just bin that one off.
okay,
Start season two.
okay. But yeah, so like you see a lot of his comedic timing for that, and it comes through in Guardians so much. And Bradley Cooper, I really liked as much as I shouldn't, but I remember when I was younger, I really liked the Hangover films, and he was obviously in them. So I was like, oh, the funny man from The Hangover. Obviously, he's done more dramatic stuff, like American Sniper was super, super traumatizing, dramatic. I can't remember what he's done. He did a. What's the one with Lady Gaga?
Star is Born.
That's it. So he did that. Vin Diesel. I didn't really watch a lot of Vin Diesel stuff beforehand. Think and obviously I had watched a lot of Batista stuff because a lot of Batista stuff was wrestling. So he was ironically enough the person I was most aware of. And obviously Zoe Saldana had done Avatar, but that's proper acting. We'll leave that. Come on,
Oh,
wrestling.
I thought you were going to say Crossroads, the one she did with Britney Spears. That's top tier
Oh,
acting.
I didn't know that.
I have not seen Cross. I've never seen Avatar. I still don't know anyone who has. I've never met someone face to face who's told me they've seen Avatar, and
I've seen Avatar.
I don't believe
Although,
anyone's seen Avatar.
in fairness, I didn't really. Again, Ri was wanting to watch the new one that was coming out, so she obviously was like, "Liam, you have to watch the first one." I was like, "Okay, it's only be like what an hour and a half, 2 hours." No, it was a lot longer than that. I think what's the first Avatar clocking in at like 2.5 hours to 3 hours
I don't know, too long for me to try.
of me sitting watching blue people running around. I was like, okay, that's fine. Like it's a good film. I can't deny that. A lot of weird conflicting messages, but it's a good film. And then I watched the next one in IMAX, and I was sitting there for like 3.5 hours, and then it was literally about an hour of the film is just them playing with whales in the water. I'm sitting here like I'm getting further and further down in my seat, just yeah, this is good. Ree's looking over at me like Ree's looking over at me like, are you enjoying this? As I'm sitting here like, yeah, it's really good, babe. I'm having fun.
Yeah, nothing I've heard, like it's obviously it's made billions, but nothing I've heard makes me want to see it. It was like, no,
Yeah.
this seems like a lot of time. I mean, if I
I
want
think.
to waste my time for like 3 hours, I'll watch Eternals again and you know, look at
Oh,
knives.
fantastic. That's a really good segue back to the MCU. Now we're
There we
back to the
go.
MCU.
After two, this is what, 205 episodes. I've got to learn how to do segues somehow. This, but oh God, Guardians, what a terrible film. Anyway, right. So yeah, so that was Guardian. I don't think we really spoke about the actual content, but of course, this is the introduction to the Infinity Stones, really
Yes, which
probably.
James Gunn just made up, I found out.
Which seems
Or
bizarre.
like the collector and how he was obviously telling you about the Infinity Stones, and he's like, this is the Power Stone, blah blah, they're all but from like different what they called Eternals? Not Eternals. No, that's
Celestials, is it?
Celestials, that's it. And they all held like different things. Apparently James Gunn just made that up in an hour, and then the entirety of the rest of like the whole like Infinity Saga was built off bullshit that James Gunn just wrote. And I was like, oh, that's fantastic stuff to learn. But I think just yeah, obviously a lot about it is these misfits come together when they like all go to prison, and they break out, and then they have to go and they have this like little orb that's got an Infinity Stone in it, and they go to the collector, it blows up because one of the collector's like helpers is like, I don't want to work for you anymore, grabs the stone and she blows up. And then it's just Ronan's the one down thing about the film, I will say.
Just as he didn't look that threatening, or it was just.
I think he's a good villain. He's a good villain, but he's just kind of that's the only thing I would say is generic about Guardians. I think Ronan, his motivation is pretty much I'm a space racist and don't like this particular race of people. No, that sounds atrocious. I don't like this particular he doesn't like what is it? He doesn't like no it's not Nova Corps.
Yeah,
It's
the Nova Corps and. The Kree had a big thing, and then they've had a, what was it, a treaty, a peace treaty, and Ronan doesn't accept.
he doesn't like the treaty. He doesn't like the treaty, so he's like, I want to destroy the Kree people or some pish. I think he might be Kree. I don't know. I can't remember. Anyway, he basically wants to destroy this planet, and then the Guardians have to stop him. That's the only thing I think is like his motivations could have been a bit more fleshed out, because the only thing I really know about him is he doesn't like this people because like that's it. But realistically, I don't really care that much because the Guardians, like all the other characters, are so well fleshed out. Like Yondu is incredibly fleshed out, and we'll talk more about him in the second film, obviously.
Definitely, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yondu, it's this. He was kind of a side character in this one, but the second one, Jesus, is probably possibly one of my favorite scenes of the trilogy of
Yeah.
films. But yeah, any particular favorite moments in the first film? Before
I
we talked about, we talked. Sorry, before we do that, before we talked about the cast, of course, Glenn Close was in it as well, and John C. Reilly. but who was supposed to be, whose second pick to be Star Lord was Glenn Howerton. And we're talking about
Was who,
parts,
sorry?
Glenn Howerton.
Really?
Yeah. So you're
Oh,
thinking
I didn't
back
know
about
that.
it's either Andy Dwyer or Dennis from Always Sunny, which I can't imagine it
Yeah,
because Pratt does such a good job.
you always hear about these like weird casting decisions though. Like I remember, like not to go to Spider-Man again, but it's the one that comes to mind a lot when you hear about what if scenarios. Apparently, Leonardo DiCaprio was supposed to be in like James Cameron's version of Spider-Man, which had been the first film before it got pawned off to a different. Yeah, I know, weird. And then when Tobey Maguire was being a dickhead and during the filming of Spider-Man 2, they were gonna like he was said he had like a sore back or some pish like that, and was wanting more money. Effectively, love you, Toby, but you're a dickhead. But then they were planning on getting like Jake Gyllenhaal to replace him in the second film, which mental to me. But then you hear about all these weird casting decisions, like who could have been cast, who the character could have been. And I can't imagine Star Lord being anyone else than Chris Pratt.
Absolutely, I think. Yeah, I think, I do. From bits and pieces I see of Always Sunny, I think Glenn Howerton's got really good comedic timing, but it's a different kind of. It's not,
Yeah.
I don't think it's a nice and fluffy kind of humor. It's more of a. It's hilarious because you get so angry kind of humor. So it just wouldn't have worked the same. Anyway,
Yeah.
so that was my tangent there. Some favorite moments from the first film.
There's a scene where so they're all in the prison and Rocket is like pretty much comes over to Peter and Gamora and they're sitting at a table, so it's a big wide shot. And they're sitting in the foreground at the table. So it's Peter, Gamora, and Rocket, and they're talking about how they're going to break out. And Rocket's going over this really in-depth plan. I think you know where I'm going with this.
Yes.
And Groot's just wandering around in the background, and he's like, "We need to take this like thing off the wall, and we need to take the alarm off. But we need to do it in a particular way where it's not going to set off the entire security alarm, and we need to get all this stuff before we take it off the wall." Blah blah blah. And you see in the background, Groot's just taking this fucking thing off the wall, and he's like tearing it off. And eventually, once Rocket finishes his little thing of his little plan, Groot pulls it off, the alarm goes, Rocket looks around and is like, or we could just do all that shit now. And then
Yeah.
just a close-up shot on Rocket going, oh. I'm like, yeah, I relate to that a lot. Or there's other scenes, particularly the one in the bar with Rocket. A lot of my scenes are going to be with Rocket because he's probably my favorite character, not just in Guardians, but in the entirety of the MCU. Because for being a CGI raccoon, he's so like in depth and layered. But Rocket, I think another one of my favorite scenes is when they're in the bar and they're obviously a bit drunk, and like Rocket is like going to shoot Drax, and he does a whole speech about how you called me vermin, you called me like monster, you think I'm just some little thing, I didn't ask to get like made and torn apart over and over and over again. It's just. It's a very emotional scene for Rocket, and I think obviously it's like shows a lot of his backstory and how hurt he actually is deep down, and how he kind of masked that through not showing any emotion and stuff like that. And I have, oh God, I really want to talk about one particular scene in Guardians 2, but we'll wait until we get there. But I think what you'll find with me when I'm talking about these films is it's a lot of when these characters are showing like super in depth and more. Throwing like super traumatic emotions for different ways. Like for obviously Rocket, like an outburst like that when he's pissed, and then kind of like showing that he obviously still appreciates his new friends and stuff like that. Yeah, brilliant. Ma, chef's kiss, 5 stars.
So for my yeah that bit with Groot taking off and the whole prison thing really. Not so much for just the scene as well, but when I watched it in the movies, in the movies, God, I sound so old there. In the talkies,
In my day.
back in my day, there was it the first guard you see that has the big mustache. It when I was even younger and I watched Hollyoaks, he was like the big baddie, Brendan, like the big Irish baddie, scary dude. And
Oh.
to see him wandering at the front of this line of folk, I'm like going, and it took me out for a moment, just go. Oh, it's Brendan from Hollyoaks. That's where he's ended up. But yeah, so that whole prison scene, though, between Nathan Fillion's cameo of getting lifted up by,
Oh my God, I forgot he was in that.
yep. So had that, and then of course the bit you mentioned, is, and you need to go get the leg as well. Which now, when you watch Volume 3, it actually is bittersweet when you think about why he does that kind of thing. It's just it's just
Yeah.
amazing. But you're right. I think Groot, Rocket's one of those that. I think you enjoy as he is, and then when you see the last film, you appreciate him more when you watch the first two back.
I think you always know there's like this super like traumatic experience, and this like this little creature has gone through a lot of shit, but you don't really experience it until you get to volume three. Great. Huh?
And Drax, just Drax in general, with when they're battling folk and all that kind of stuff, and he just goes, finger around neck means death.
Yes.
And things like that. Just
Drax
little
just
things like that. It was just.
taking everything very literally, right? Because he doesn't get metaphors. So any single time like Peter like says something, or it's like, oh, it'll go straight over his head. No, it would not. I would simply catch it. I'm like, okay, yeah, fair enough.
And you said, we really kind of didn't mention Batista, because I suppose for some of us, seeing Batista in a big film like this, that's pretty cool. Because I don't know what he did beforehand. Maybe it's the Scorpion King 5, whatever, and or oh, he did that one with Rob Van Dam, Wrong Side of Town, I think it was called. So his resume wasn't that great before this film,
Which
and
is
he's.
mental when you think about it, because his resume now is like fantastic, like genuinely great.
The fact that he hasn't been drawn in back to a Fast film is remarkable at the moment.
I think he doesn't need it though,
Oh
which
no, definitely doesn't. That's the thing. Yeah, he doesn't need it, but the fact that Vin hasn't tried to try and get, or maybe he has tried to get Batista involved, because like he looks ready built for that kind of film, but his acting chops means he's not.
Yeah,
He's too subtle.
exactly.
He's too subtle for a Fast film. That's what he is.
Which is mental when we're talking about him as a blue alien who doesn't get metaphors. Like his
Exactly.
acting's too subtle for a fast film. But yeah, my favorite bit of trivia about Batista is WWE thought his movie would absolutely bomb and he would come like crawling back. It was like, oh, he's gonna call us sooner or later. But no, mate, he went from Guardians to like Blade to the new Blade Runner film to obviously Endgame, one of the biggest fucking movies ever. And then he obviously was in Knives Out. He's done so much shit, and now WWE's like, Dave, why aren't you calling us back to take our phone calls?
I know James Bond as well. He's one of the Bond
Spectre,
films.
yeah.
Yeah, so he's and he was like in Blade Runner and that, when you see comments about the film, a lot of them were about Batista, which is just nuts to think. Especially when you consider like one of his most gifable moments was not just his "Give me what I want" speech, but that one where I think Mark Henry shakes the ropes and then Lisa just like
Oh no.
throws himself backwards like a delay. And you think that guy is one of the best actors in the world right now?
The Mark Henry gift is so, because I think the like obviously at the time it's fucking hilarious, but I think being a bit more like being a wrestler at the moment and you see like that stuff and it's like I think he obviously just had a fucking like bit of a brain fart and was like pushed and was like, wait, I'm supposed to take a bump. It's literally like slipped on a banana peel. I felt so fucking like you're watching now. I'm like, oh shit. Especially like there's also the one his last match for WrestleMania where he trips on the ropes.
Of course.
Yeah, he's getting into the ring and he trips and you hear Shawn Michaels go, oh no. And then he does a double take so they can re-record it. Smart shit on Dave on the Big Batista's part, but he does like a double take so he can re-record it. And I'm like, fair enough. But yeah, like I think. I was getting into wrestling like properly around 2010, so that's obviously when he was like on the way out. So the only stuff I really remember a lot for Batista was getting thrown off a car over the limit by John Cena, getting his legs duct taped to the ring post at Extreme Rules before that, or just getting beat by John Cena at WrestleMania. So that's my experience with Batista.
So yeah, coming to this, you weren't like, oh, this guy beat the Undertaker, well, didn't beat the Undertaker at WrestleMania, but I ran him close and all that kind of stuff. You're just like, oh, this is a guy that looks like a bit of a tit on the on these shows, because he keeps getting thrown and tied up in these weird and wacky situations, and here he is in
Pretty
Guardians of the
much.
Galaxy. So you mentioned a lot of the we've mentioned a lot of the good moments. We've missed loads because it's one of those films where it is a
Yeah.
joke a minute, but they fit the context of the story going through it.
If I'd known we're doing a proper in-depth review, I would have known what Skinner did and bring notes, but unfortunately I can't.
That's
Unfortunately, I
okay.
can't go back and do that.
I am as prepared as you are, which is fine. I'm like I said,
Oh shit.
I got overwhelmed by how prepared Ian was. So I was like, my God, all I did literally all I did is I went to ChatGPT and put review of Austin Powers because I thought, oh, that'll be funny. I'll just read that out at the end. I never got around to it because he was just so impassioned about it, which is fine because it's an amazing film. So I was all cool with that. Right. So before we go into the next film, we'll answer some questions. That seems to be a nice way to break it up. So that's volume one ticked, done. Oh, the music as well. Well, actually, we'll talk about the
Yes.
music in depth more towards the end because there's questions about
Yeah.
that. We do have a question from the mighty Caleb Valhalla. He asked, can the mighty Caleb be Alex's stepdad again whenever Kurt is
Do
busy?
you know about this?
Oh, he sent me a picture. Well, he's attached a picture as well. Which
So
looks like him and Ron
basically,
Mills are drinking while you guys are confused.
last year, July for Cruel Summer, Reckless Intent. It was meant to be me and Steven wrestling the Sea Bears. Steven got COVID, so he obviously couldn't show up. So, and Caleb was already booked in a match on that show, wrestling someone else. So for a lot of the time beforehand, I was like, I didn't know who my partner was going to be. I honestly thought a lot for it was. I honestly thought my partner was going to be the referee. I thought he's a lovely. He's a lovely guy called Mike, who I adore. But I thought it was going to be him. So we were like having to think about what we could do with him in the match, or because it would just be me getting beat up, and then Mike would come in and get pinned. That would be it. But Caleb's opponent didn't show up, so Caleb was like, "Ah, I'm your father now, Alex Webb." I was like, "Oh, hello." So he was my father, but unfortunately, he was drunk during the match because Rob Mills is a pirate that comes out with rum. Caleb is a Viking that comes out with some substance in his horn, which I assume is alcoholic. So they both came out and started drinking during the match. I came in, locked up with Rob Mills. He smelled of alcohol. I was like, "How much have you had?" And he said, "More than you," in the very drunk Jack Sparrow-esque way. I was like, "Fantastic." I did a bit with him, did a bit with Bear, tagged up to Caleb. Caleb came in, went, "Oh-ho!" Rob came in, went, "What does the pirate go? Ahoy!"
I don't know. I'm sure you had Jack
Yeah.
Sparrow.
And then Caleb went, "Oh, you have alcohol." Rob was like, "Yes, I do." And then they went and sat and drank at the front of the ring as they tagged me and Baron. And then I went over and was like, "Boys, what are you doing?" And they looked at me and was like, "We're drinking." I was like, It's a match. Oh, it's a competition." And he went, "Competition." And then he had a drinking competition in the middle of the ring as I stood there and said to Caleb, "I do not want to lose another father to alcoholism. Please come back and tag me." I'm glad you're laughing at that because no one laughed at it during the match.
That's even better.
Literally, I said it and crickets. I feel like everyone was more concerned than anything else. Like they're like, "Oh, what's this? What's happened to his dad?" No, so then Caleb tags me back in, and I have to take the horn off him as he stumbles out of the ring. I'm like, "Here you go." We do a little bit. Eventually, Caleb hits a hell ride, pins a bear 1-2-3. We get the win. Caleb goes to offer me a drink and goes, "Oh no, you're too young." And I'm like, "Come on now." And I said to him, "Caleb, I'm 24." And he said, "I'm 4,000 years old," as he then walks away drinking. And I was like, "You know what? You've beat me here."
Oh, I love Caleb. I think he's just—he's a wonderful man of God slash whatever creed he
He's
is.
a wonderful entity, is what I would like to
Entity.
say.
That's the that sums it up. Yeah, absolutely an entity. So yeah, I think well, I've got a questions here. We do have one from Asian Sensation, which I'm gonna have to do a share screen. You know, technological here. Let's try to do this without breaking
Yeah, this is
stuff.
a photo. I've seen the photo. I've seen the photo before.
Well, I've got to do it for the viewership as well. Hang on, share screen. How do I do
Oh,
this?
Billy.
My God, I can do
Oh
this.
no.
Oh, actually, if I click the word share screen, I'll do it. Okay, share.
Oh.
There we go. I think.
Yeah.
Ooh, yes. So it's thoughts
Oh,
on this photo
gee.
with your dad.
So thoughts on this photo. Disgust comes to mind. Anger, pain, shame. Funny story about this. This was obviously a gala day, and Stephen and Omar got announced as the Asian sensation, Stephen Miles, and then Air Miles was Omar. So That was our names during the match. Stephen was the Asian sensation, Stephen Miles, and then Omar was just Air Miles. So the ring announcer did a fantastic job there.
It's a big. Oh, so is he now like a monster? Well, he was a monster
big,
in Reckless Stent.
Big Stevie. He was Deacon. Yeah, he was Deacon's. He was Deacon's like zombie monster for a while. I think he was the general manager for a hot minute too. But yeah, just for some reason at this gala day, I heard he wasn't on the ball.
He has added another question there. So for folks that are unaware and listen to the audio, you can look at the video or just look on Twitter. Was there. He also did ask, do you still forget what side is the front of your gear?
Oh, fuck off, Omar. Jesus Christ. Right. Okay, funny story about this. So the very first WrestleZone show I ever did, I was cutting about with my gear back to front for the majority of the show, and I didn't even know. I think it was, I had obviously worn these shorts before, but I just put them on the wrong way around and didn't plot that I put them on the wrong way around. I would get them out, but they're in my case, so CBA. But yeah, they're like these orange shorts that I had just gotten not that long ago, probably before lockdown even, but I hadn't really been wearing them that long. Just put them on the wrong way around. And it took until, I think Omar was the one that actually mentioned it to me, like, is your shorts on the wrong way around? Promo photos at this point, by the way. So if you look on my Instagram far enough down, there's photos of me. But yeah, effectively, I just was wearing my shorts on back to front, and Omar will not let it slide. So yeah, so during the birthday bonanza, I'm gonna bully him relentlessly for it.
See, for someone who's mocking you for attire, I don't let him forget he wore Converse in one of his first matches, and that's
Billy. I read that review when it first came out. So
that is the
most ruthless I have ever seen you write a review, by the way. Like, I don't know if it was because you're looking through like a fish eye for the majority of the show, but fuck me, that was the most ruthless I have ever seen you do a show before.
I don't think I've ever been that bad since. Like, that just caught me really on the worst day possible, and I hated everything about it. And I was like, I can't. I'm Mr. Positive on these reviews. I can't do anything positive about this. This is awful. It's the worst thing I've ever seen. And I wasn't. If I wasted 40 minutes watching it, I'm still writing about it because I could have just left it. Nobody needed to know. Nobody. No. It's still up. The show is still on YouTube.
Hey, fuck off! It's still up.
It's still up.
Oh, right. See, in this case, then. See, any time Omar pipes up on Twitter, I am going to go find that show. Like, I can't be having it anymore.
I'm sure it is, because I wrote about it, and then, that's not the right word, but, you know, I'm not a linguistic person. But yeah, I wrote about it, and the next weekend, it was one of the Trinity Union Square shows, and Johnny Lyons was on the show. And I was walking over to it, because we were just going to catch a bit of it, go get food, and then come back from the end. And I saw he was in the ring. I thought, oh no.
Yeah.
Oh shit. And then he came out and he went, oh, I agreed with you. Oh, thank God. Because I really did not need you to shout at me here.
So, I've had that fear a few times with promos. And not to some extent it was a review, but I think the last promo I did for Disco was couldn't meet Steven, so he just sent me a voice note and I just made a promo around that. Mm-hmm. But it was for the walk. Thank you. It was for the Woke Academy. I think I ended the line with, we're going to send you crying back to Daddy Andy. And I was like, well, go down well. Or will someone take offense to that? But did it anyway. And everyone, it was apparently well received. So I'm quite happy with that.
Andy taking offense at something? I don't believe it. I don't think that happened.
Oh, no.
Yeah, W3L Action Academy Unleashed. 1,600 viewers, views. 5 years ago, still up there.
Wait, how many views?
1,600.
Oh, that's 1,600 too many.
Oh, that's just. I would say seek it out, but don't. That's. Although, if you want to make screen grabs of Omar and his Converse, then feel free, because, you know, it makes me laugh every time. Yes, and also he is on the Day of Birth Bonanza for those that aren't keeping track on the social media. He has been booked, whether he appears or not. I don't know, but at the moment
it should appear. Yeah. It should appear.
Did you see the picture of the prize that you're getting if you win?
I did, yes. I seen it, and it's very shiny and lovely and nice. There we go.
I spent money on this.
Although I do think I am not an encyclopedia for wrestling knowledge, so I am just there to have a good, to have some good crap and take the piss.
As you know, there's only one wrestling round anyway, so I'm sure you'll be all right.
Is there any YouTube rounds? I'm just wondering for you know, for you know, hey, who's the most subscribed wrestler in Scotland? Just you know, just hey, hi.
I don't know. I don't know. That could be an Ian Skinner's question lot. I don't know.
I'm taking the piss. I don't want any question to relate to me.
I did a first draft of it. I did have a couple of Guardians questions in there, and then when you said you wanted to be on, like, can't have those questions in. I'm going to take them. So you know, so it is fair. It is fair for everyone. Although I realize I've got a cars question I need to take out because Omar is like the king of cars. So sorry, Omar, that question.
Is he?
He loves Lightning McQueen.
Oh, that's a strange bit of tidbit. I never knew about Omar, but fair enough.
There you go. So yeah, you can when he hits you with his whatever his submission move, I think it's called like the Kachow, the big Kachowski. There you go.
Oh, the last chance for you.
Yeah, that's the one.
Where he's like bridging back. Yeah.
So volume two, because I realised we spoke about an hour, we've only actually covered one film so far.
Oh, fantastic! Great.
Volume 2 of Guardians of the Galaxy came out May 2017, and it was good. I enjoyed it. I really enjoyed Volume 2, and it was, of course, we're a good bit into the MCU phases now, yeah. So we're a good bit in, and like you said, the first film in your much more popular than this one will be video probably when it comes to viewership. You did say that the first film set a precedent for the rest for movies following, that you have
yeah.
jokes and quips and what have you. This is a very quippy film, was volume two.
I'll actually quickly check, because I think the video was on like 150k, but it's got a much more harsh like dislike ratio. Yeah, basically a lot of my videos normally come to like 97% like ratio, but this one's like on 90% with like 1,000 dislikes. So there are people that like disagree with me on this.
Yeah.
But I do feel like it's set a precedent, and I think this one, I don't think it doubles down, because it is just as funny, but again, Guardians, it suits that tone perfectly, so it works really well within those films. This one is about Peter's dad.
Yes.
Yes. And as a man that doesn't have a dad, this one hits hard. But yeah, no, so this one obviously is a lot about your... I think James Gunn said it really well. The first film's about the mother, the second film is about the father, and the third film is about himself, like finding yourself, like yourself. So, but this one obviously looks at Peter and finding his real dad, which is Ego, the living planet, who he thinks is a lovely, lovely human being who's not human being, a lovely planet that is going to teach him the ways of being a celestial, because Peter can obviously like handle the little orbs of blue magic and shit like that. But then obviously he finds out that Ego is really just wanting to expand across the universe and become everything. And obviously Peter's in has is like, no, that's not good, but you're my dad, but oh my god, I'm so conflicted. And then he finds out Ego put the tumor in his mom's head, and then he's like, you get that lovely gif, that lovely meme even, of Peter going what, and then shooting the fuck out of Ego. But yeah, no, in terms of the film, I really enjoyed this one as well. I do not think it's as good as the first Guardians, however.
Oh, yeah, no.
However, that's like saying a 10 out of 10 isn't as good as a 9 out of 10. The film's still fucking great. Like, it's still, like, top tier of MCU films. I do feel it's not as good as the original. However, there is one scene in it. One scene. I don't know if you want to talk about Mantis or anyone like that just now, but there is one scene in it that always hits me so hard. Because it's Mantis is Ego's little helper. She can touch someone and feel their emotions, make them feel different emotions, or put them to sleep. That's her powers. And then she forms this kind of weird little relationship with Drax, where Drax is like, you're hideous, you're ugly, but that's a good thing. And it's really funny. But then there's a scene where they're both sitting on like these steps, looking out onto like Ego's planet, and it's like a big, beautiful garden. And Drax is like reminiscing about his children. About his daughter even, and his wife, and Mantis like touches him, and she starts like bawling, like properly crying, and then it's just Drax kind of just looking out with like a nice little smile on his face, and that says so much more about the character than you could ever tell me just by saying, just by Drax saying how he feels, like that little scene there of Drax like blissfully looking out into a field, thinking about his family, and then obviously Mantis putting a hand on him and her bursting out in tears tells you all the like the sadness and pain that like Drax has bottled up inside him, but also how happy he is about the memories that he has for his family. It's such a beautiful scene. It's really well done. And then speaking about beautiful scenes, anything to do with Yondu in this film?
Oh yes. We'll talk about the things I didn't like in it a bit, but yeah, Yondu, the whole scene from them getting captured, or of the mutiny for the
Yeah,
Ravagers and
with Taserface.
Taserface, who is weird because we watched what's it called, that thing, it's got Milo Ventimiglia in it. It's like they go in the past, the future, and you get the stories of all these three triplets. It's not that important, but the guy in it, one of the guys, is the guy who plays Taserface. You looked at him and go, how did you play Taserface? Because you're he's quite a quite a handsome man. And he's like, no, you can't have been Taserface. That's weird. But yeah, the whole thing with
Prosthetics are a mental thing.
I know, just incredible. But yeah, the whole Taserface thing, and then the mutiny and the whole thing going back and forth with Baby Groot to get this
Get the
the
fin.
prototype Finn was just amazing. And I don't know, I enjoyed it at the time. I enjoy it more now that I've got a little boy that looks at me just as clueless,
Yeah.
and that he picks up stuff and just like points it at you, and you go, I don't know why you've given me this, but okay, kind of thing. It's oh, yeah.
I think when you can look at like the films and you can find a relatable aspect from your life, it hits a lot harder.
Yeah. And then, of
I
course,
think,
the whole coming a little bit closer bit with the arrow.
yeah. I think I think one of my favorite things is like Peter gets saved by Yondu later on in the film, and Yondu's like floating down with his using his arrow, and then Peter's like, "Ha, you look like Mary Poppins." Obviously, Yondu doesn't know who the fuck Mary Poppins is, and he's like, "Is he cool?" And Peter, like in that moment, is like, "Yeah, he's the coolest." But it's like, I think it's at that point he doesn't want to take the piss out of Yondu or anything like that. It's very much like kind of love there because he's obviously saved him. He's like, "I want you to know that how great you are." I love that. But yeah, I think Yondu's whole thing throughout the film, it does make it very obvious what his fate is going to be from the start, because Sylvester Stallone shows up and is like, "When you die, Yondu, we'll never fly the colors at your funeral," or some pish like that. And then
Yeah,
funnily enough, he dies at the end of the film.
well, that
And then they
happens.
do.
It's one of those things, though. Sorry, I'll let you finish your point. I've interrupted you.
No, I wasn't really much more a point there. I was just gonna say, and then they do shine the colors at his funeral because like someone made a few calls. But it's lovely to see, because then Rocket's whole thing for that is he spent all this time with Yondu throughout this film, because Yondu is very much like Rocket. Rocket pushes everyone away from him because he's scared something will happen to them or something like that. I'm not as articulate as I would be if I had a script in front of me, but it's fine. But yeah.
Yeah, I was just gonna say that's the thing you notice when you watch these MCU films specifically and Guardians ones. It hammers home what's gonna happen in the first 15, 20 minutes. It tells you how this film's gonna end, and you don't realize it until you watch back. You go, this is how the film's gonna end. It's told me
Yeah.
right at the start how it ends, so I know how it's gonna end. But yeah, Yondu starting, of course, he's at the, was it the brothel, the
How
robot
about I was
brothel.
like space brothel is probably the best way you can put it.
Yeah, had that, and yeah, and of course the whole thing with the jump in the whatever is jumping the jumps, go with that.
Oh
But,
yeah, going to like hyperdrive and doing like
yeah,
75 jumps in one as they're going like.
that, and then of course before that you had the whole arrow bit, and it really was, it's one of the first films in a long time before then that I actually cried at the end.
Really?
Because yeah, when at the end, of course, when the colors were flying, all that kind of stuff, and Kraglin gives Quill the Zune, and he plays
Yes.
father and son,
Yeah.
and I was like, woo! It was proper like going, oh my God, this is such a deeply emotional moment that he's playing father and
I
son.
think
Oh.
the themes of it, of Peter desperately wanting a kind of father figure, but then realizing he had one the entire time in Yondu. it hits a bit hard for me as well, because obviously I take the piss out of it all the time, but I didn't really have a dad growing up. So I think when you desperately want something like that, and then you realize you've kind of had that figure throughout your life as well. Mine's my granddad. So like you always kind of have those realizations when they're not there anymore. I think that's what hit really hard with me, because you kind of think like, so long I've looked for this one thing that was standing right in front of me. I think that's such a powerful and emotional beat in the film. It's never really said, it's just shown, and it's yeah, I love it for that.
I had that, and it was just, like I say, it wasn't, I think it was a bit, more of a broader film. I think it was a bit, it tried to do, it did the big emotional bits really well, and then it tried to do the comedy bits, which sometimes for me didn't always hit. The one that didn't hit for me at all was when the big CGI battles happening towards the end, and Quill, so Eagle became like a big rock version of himself, and
And
then
Crow became fucking Pac-Man.
yeah, I hated that. That was the only bit of the whole film I was like, that's a bit shit, to be honest. I don't like that. Even though he said he was gonna, that's what he was gonna do. And he said, oh, he's gonna make a, he's gonna be a 7 foot, well, 80 foot, whatever, Pac-Man in Heather Locklear.
Pac-Man, yeah.
He told us what he was gonna do if he had the power. But even then when I saw it, I was like, oh, it's a bit shit, that.
I get what you mean there. I quite liked it because it suits Peter. I think if he was had these powers, he would do something like that. But I think obviously it's like kind of him, like Yondu saying to him, like, "Boy, I don't fly the arrow of my brain. I fly out of my heart," as his like face gets covered up in rocks. But then Peter's like says, "You shouldn't have killed my mom and squished my Walkman," and I'm like, "That's a fucking great line." But I can understand how it can take people out of the moment, because it's quite funny as well.
Yeah, I think it was because he used the Pac-Man sound, which didn't
Yeah, it goes
help.
waka waka waka.
Yeah, and I was like, going, oh no,
I get
you went a bit too close to the sun there, James Gunn. That was a bit, I
that.
mean, you didn't burn yourself like Taika Waititi did for Love and Thunder, but yeah, you've come
Oh.
close. You've come close
See
there.
what I mean about the comedy being too much sometimes. You know,
Yeah,
like fucking hell.
but
Like four.
that's it. When you
Oh.
go Volume One and Volume Two, it increased in the comedy, but I think it still kept it reined in. When you see Thor 3 and then Thor 4, that's when they give too much control, and it just didn't.
Try saying 4-4 four times fast. Because I can't pronounce TH words, so I just sound like I'm saying 4-4-4-4-4. What word did I say there, Billy? Did I say four or did I say four? You can't tell, can you?
I can't. I don't know if Thor is going to do something for, but it's that's an example of the extreme of it going too far. Whereas even though there was bits that missed in Volume Two, the comedy and the heartfelt moments, they still kind of they balanced quite well.
I think in terms of there's something there for everything with the Guardians films. I feel like if the comedy is a bit too much for you sometimes, it's not so blatantly in your face. Like Peter Quill isn't an idiot in the film. No one's character is damaged based on the comedy, whereas in Love and Thunder, I feel like Thor's character is made to pretty much be an idiot throughout the majority of the film. And that's to the detriment of his character. Like especially because like say in Endgame, like he could have been like he had the opportunity to stop Thanos, but he didn't. And because he didn't like go for the head, as Thanos says. But then Thor is like freaking with like guilt and depression. But then in the end game, and I know we need some levity in it because the whole film's about half the universe being murdered pretty much. But we spend a lot of the film just, haha, Thor's fat now. That's the joke. And it doesn't really explore. Suppose there's elements of it exploring his depression, say when they go back in time, but it could have been more than just a throwaway punchline. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely. I can't agree more. Anything else I kind of want to pick up on Volume Two?
I think in terms of villains, Guardians have always been, that's not like a lacking point, but I feel like sometimes the Guardians films are so good at developing the side characters, the themes, the main characters and their character arcs throughout the film, and so good at exploring all that, the music, all that shit. But sometimes villains can be a little bit of a side attraction. That's until the third film, because I fucking love the High Evolution. Not love, but I love to hate the High Evolutionary. But with Ego, again, I think I think they were constantly improving the villains. Ronan was a bit generic. Ego was a lot better in terms of obviously having a personal connection to Peter, and then his motivations were still like the generic, like, oh, I want to take over the world, but he's a fucking planet and his name's Ego. What do you expect? But I think his powers that he does been a bit more visually striking than just I am a large man that will throw stuff at you in blue, like blue orbs and blue tentacles at you. You know what I mean?
And be able to turn into David Hasselhoff randomly.
Because like, yeah. Oh God, I forgot about that. I wasn't randomly because it was like he was like saying like I tried to pick the form that was best, and then David Hasselhoff shows up. Is like, sweet to you. No, I enjoyed the film, but as you said, I feel like sometimes the comedy can take you out of it, and I feel like the villains sometimes can be a little bit lacking. I feel like the Guardians, they constantly got better and better though, so that's what it is. Nebula is also fantastic in the films. I feel like we gloss over her a lot.
Oh yeah, absolutely. So it had the you mentioned the audio stuff being amazing. The whole the bit that they kind of put out in the stuff beforehand with the bomb between Groot and Rocket trying to figure out the bomb, that still made me absolutely just fucking piss myself off, and it was just so funny. Just again, I
It's
find
just
it
when
funnier now because I've got a little one that just does the same, just goes, yeah. And they
it's
go, no, don't. Yeah. No.
it's
Don't touch that.
the
Yeah.
whole bit beforehand where like Rocket's like, here, do we have any tape? He's like, why would we have tape? You be alone on tape, we'll ask Nebula. And it's like he goes and asks everyone. And he's like, "Did you ask Nebula?" And he's like, "No, she was standing right next to Yondu when I asked him." So you didn't ask everyone. And then he turns back around, and Groot's just fucked off with the detonator, and he's like, "We're all gonna die."
It's the bit just before that when he goes, Drax, have you got any tape? Yeah, Scotch tape would do. Then why did you ask? You can hear,
Although.
know the other side of that conversation without hearing it, which is even better.
There is one in terms of the comedy as well. There is one thing that I didn't particularly like, and it's such a minor thing. Drax's whole thing with his nipples.
Yes.
Yeah, where like Peter like puts the backpack that's like the jetpack on Drax and it covers his chest and he's like, "Oh, my nipples!" And I'm like, I didn't need that, but fair enough.
Drax has some very just left field stuff when he asks Ego if he has a penis, and he goes, "Yes, Drax, I have a penis, and it's a good one." Oh, just it's the
And
impression.
Peter's like, "Oh, Drax, what are you asking about that? It's gross." And he's like, "I would ask my father how he impregnated my mother every winter solstice." And I'm like, "Oh, this is where we're going with this film."
The more I speak about it, the more I feel like I'm wrong. It was just a banger, full start to finish. It was
Real stop. I think you can always find stuff that you're not going to enjoy with any film, but I think in general, got like both the Volume 1 and Volume 2 are fucking fantastic films. It's just, which one do you prefer, really?
It has every volume one, I think, for me out of the two, but I can see why people would say volume two. That's,
Yeah, of course.
right. So go back to some questions, I suppose, and then we'll go into volume, because I can't really speak a lot about volume three, because this goes out, it's still about a month that it's been in the cinema, and don't want to spoil it too much. We can be
Oh,
a
we're not
bit,
spoiling it. Oh, God, okay.
we can spoil it, but I don't want to, like, we haven't went through the plot of any film so far really, but I don't want to like play on too many things, because it's an amazing film that people should go see. Back to Facebook, we have Scully with more Peppa Pig videos in all caps. There's that.
Oh, great. Cheers. Cheers, Scully. Cheers. Is this version 4 or version 5? Because every CW show I go to, Scully ends up breaking and there has to be a new Scully to take its place.
Jeez. I don't know if I don't, it just says Scully. I don't know if he did a, oh, apparently one of the verses did, of course, a Let's Talk Wrestling podcast. But we got Tom with favorite Saints Row game and why is it the reboot?
Oh, sorry, give me a minute. Oh, I didn't know Scully had such high blood pressure for that podcast.
He's got
Anyway,
no blood. He's a skull, so it's even
oh
better.
my God. No, yeah, with the favorite Saints Row game, fuck you, Tom. It's not the reboot. It's I feel like people think I really adore Saints Row. I do, don't get me wrong, but it's not like my favorite game franchise, even though my YouTube could probably tell you differently. I think the one that I really enjoyed the most is obviously the second one, because it's the most like grounded and the most it's got so much customization, so much shit you can do. It's probably my favorite. It's probably my favorite Saints Row game. And it's in my favorite games list as well. Just cause like I feel like everything's more grounded, but there's obviously got these like stupid over the top aspects of it. Like one of the fucking one of the gangs you have to beat up is run by a man who is pretty much Papa Shango, like just like doing voodoo. And then he sell like there's like a gang called, I can't remember what it's called, but they're basically like they're the drug dealer side of it. And then there's like the scene where you beat him, and he's like, you shoot him, he gets back up. You shoot him like 16 times, he gets back up, and you're like, fuck this, and you cut off his head, and then you just throw it on a conveyor belt and he gets boxed up and like shipped off somewhere. I'm like, that'll be a lovely delivery, Amazon delivery for some family. Like, but no, I think Saints Row 2 is my favorite just because it worked really well for what it was.
There we go. And the last question I've got through Facebook is Sean McCulloch with why haven't you reviewed Deadly Premonitions yet?
Do you know what Deadly Premonitions is?
I have no idea.
Okay, it's a fucking batshit insane game, which I do not want to touch at the moment.
Okay.
Deadly Premonitions is pretty much like it was a game that was supposed to be like Twin Peaks. Not supposed to be, it rips off Twin Peaks a lot. But I think it's the game's doesn't work that well. I think a lot of it is broken, and also it's fucking like deranged. Like the story is so over, like I don't even know how to sum up. You just need to kind of experience Deadly Premonition before you even like begin to comprehend it. I've watched a couple reviews on it, but I don't really think I can really add any more than just doing funny memes over the top of stuff. But there's much better videos on it than I can make, so that's me at the moment.
Fair enough. So I think the last few questions we've got are really kind of overarching or Guardians 3 specific. So we'll get to that and once
Okay.
we talk about that. So between Guardians 2 and Guardians Volume 3, we had, of course, appearances in Infinity War, Endgame, Love and Thunder, and then of course the holiday special. So wee bits and pieces. I enjoyed seen them in these films, even though obviously Star Lord made it was his fault. And then we had all that, and then the holiday special, which I really enjoyed. I think it was just an hour of just a little bit of Guardians fun for an hour on Christmas Day.
I love seeing these characters back in the hands of James Gunn. I feel like with Infinity War, Endgame, and Love and Thunder, I think they didn't like the Russo brothers and Taika. How do you pronounce his name?
Taika Waititi.
Him. I think they didn't really get the characters as well as James Gunn did. Like, there's stuff that I don't think they care to really put into the films. Like, here's helmet gets destroyed in Volume 2. And then in Infinity War, he's just got this helmet back. I feel like that was a symbolic thing that James Gunn wanted to keep throughout the films, but obviously shit changes. Like again, he didn't know Gamora was going to die in Infinity War, so yeah, you'd think he'd be timed in, but no. But I think with seeing him them in the Christmas special, I was like, oh, they're back home now, boys, and it was just nice to see like some levity after all the shit that's happened, and it was a nice little break and like some Christmas fun seeing Kevin Bacon singing, which was a weird sentence.
But that's it. I mean, the year started with No Way Home,
Yes.
and then we got some dross in between, let's be honest, with things like Eternals and Doctor Strange is of a certain taste, so
Yeah.
not everyone's gonna like it. And then what I can remember what else? Although I watched Werewolf by Night way after the
Oh, that
fact,
was
and
apparently that was really good.
it was interesting. I didn't know
Good.
what to expect of it. I thought it's actually not bad. I wouldn't go back. I
Fair
wouldn't
enough.
like put it in my rewatch, but I would be if they started bringing stuff from it. Like yeah, okay, I'll throw back on.
I
Yeah,
just think
so.
Phase 4 was such a fucking mixed bag of stuff that like yeah. It's just weird to like look at anything individually and go, yeah, that was good, but then this was shit, and then that was good and then shit. It's a mixed bag to say the least.
Yeah, and the TV stuff as well, it was again a bit of a mixed bag, even though I liked
Yeah.
She-Hulk, which seemed nobody else seemed to.
I haven't watched She-Hulk, so my opinions are just I don't tend to take any opinions from Twitter, so I'll just like sit and like form my own shit. So I don't actually know the quality of She-Hulk because I haven't seen it. So.
So yeah, so it was very hit or miss, and this kind of, I think the holiday special was like, yeah, we can still do good stuff, you know. Don't worry. We had a go at stuff, but we can still do this.
We're reining it back in now, boys.
Yeah, absolutely. We threw a lot of shit at the wall, and some is stuck, but we've cleaned up a lot of it. So holiday special, yeah, lovely. Had Kevin Bacon, of course, being abducted. We've got a Drax and Mantis adventure, which I think everyone wanted because they were just
I think
adorable.
though that pairing is great together, like the way they work off each other. So I'm just happy to see more of them,
And
especially
it's
what in the third film we see more of them too.
yeah, and it's there's no like will they, won't they kind of thing. It's very much a brother sister kind of vibe.
It's like a platonic relationship, like, and that's more I want to see in superhero films rather than just like, oh, we're so in love. Like, fuck that. Just like have some banter with each other. Like, that's all I need to see.
Even though the end raised more questions than answers when Nebula got Rocket Bucky's arm as a gift.
Yeah, I don't know how that works, but yeah, we'll look past it.
We'll figure it out. We'll figure it out in the future. Speaking of, we went through all this, and Nebula, of course, played by Karen Gillan, from Inverness, being one of the major actresses that, or major characters that has such a huge arc over all these films, being
Yeah.
the sister of Gamora and pawn for Ronan and Thanos, and then
Yeah.
she's now one of the Guardians at the end, and she's got this really kind of good chemistry with everyone on the team, whether it's just a love hate kind of thing or what have you. So she's probably one of the, we talked about Batista being amazing. We all know Karen Gillan is anyway,
Yeah.
but to see her character evolve over those films is
I think Nebula is one of the like most layered in depth characters as well. It's same on par with Rocket, just because the growth that she goes through from the first Guardians through Infinity War, Endgame, all the way to the third Guardians is insane, and how much she develops as a character from being like this again. I'm much in the same vein as Rocket, like someone that's been tortured and like has had her body parts completely replaced. She's more robot than human at this point, or whatever like race she was before Thanos got his hands on her, his big purple mitts. And then he like turns her into this like machine that's fit for like killing people and this like horrible like robot version of herself. But then she like, I think throughout the film she like learns to love Gamora again, because she's like, I just want a sister to like not someone not like I just want to have someone in my life that I could care about. And Gamora's like, oh my god. And then they hug. And then in Endgame, she's like this pretty much a good like superhero at this point. And she obviously kills the past version of herself narratively, like physically, like literally and metaphorically. She's like killing her past version of herself. And I think like obviously that all goes into the third film, where she's like this she's obviously still got those bitter elements of her. But I think the development she's gone through from the first one has been insane. I also find it funny that out of Matt Smith and Karen Gillan, one of them did Endgame, Infinity War, Guardians of the Galaxy 3, and the other one did Terminator. So, you know, that was it.
Oh, there you go, swerve there at the end.
And I will be damned if I have to mention that fucking vampire film one more time.
It's generally the most angriest I've been in a podcast when I had to speak about it. Well, I didn't have to speak about it, but when I brought it up, the rage filled me, and I was untethered. And oh, it was hot. It was something people shouldn't see. I'm a calm, collected guy, unless I watch W3L Action Academy again or something.
What would you
So.
rather watch again, WFL Action Academy or Morbius?
Action Academy is like 40 minutes, so I'll easily take that.
Okay, fair enough.
But I would still be very annoyed the whole time watching it, because I'll be watching it going, oh no, why? If I have to see that ring announcer's butt crack one more time, I'm just fucking explode. It was not a good time.
You're selling it to me, Billy. I'm gonna go watch it after this.
Made for content, I suppose, at the end
I'm
of the day.
not. No. I can't. I don't want to do that. I don't want to like take other people's like bad matches and stuff like that and make content out of that. I can't do that. I have to like, if I'm taking the piss out of anyone, it's myself and no one else.
Oh, no, as I was gonna say, makes for my content. I'll speak about it, but yeah, nobody should see that again. So that brings us to our kind of finale. I'm noticing the time we have been on for quite a while, which, you know, this is how this happens. Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3. Of course, we had a little bit of kerfuffle coming into this one because James Gunn got fired for past tweets, and then
Yes.
nobody wanted to touch Guardians Volume 3 because they're like, no, James Gunn should be doing it. And then he got rehired after he made a very good Suicide Squad film. I
Oh,
enjoyed it.
yeah, fantastic.
And the amazing Peacemaker. And they were like,
Yes.
you know what, James, we need you back because you're the only one who can make a sequel with comedy that doesn't want people to turn off the whole franchise. Case in point, Thor: Love and Thunder. I like the film, but it's not a good film in
Yeah.
if we're wanting to keep this Thor character going. Like you say, it
I
kind
feel
of tainted
it
Thor.
made him a yeah, it made him a massive fucking idiot. Yeah,
Absolutely. So point three came around, and well, I think Caleb's got the best question when it comes to this one in particular. He's just put, why does the mighty Caleb's eyes leak?
because I feel like everyone like a lot of the stuff in film, like High Evolutionary is a character, right? Is someone who says he wants to make a better for like society, make like he's someone that creates like whole worlds, whole races of creatures and stuff like that. But it all spawns from him experimenting on animals and stuff like that. And I feel like anyone that's not a complete fucking sociopath will see. Like I mentioned at the start of this, I have a cat and he's like only 7 months. I look at this cat and I go, "You're a fucking little idiot who, if you clang two brain cells together, couldn't figure out what the fuck he's doing, but you're innocent and you don't know what's going on, but you have full trust in me that I'm gonna protect you, make you nice and comfortable and stuff like that." And you probably got a lot. You probably have this not the little idiot thing, but you probably have the same thing with your dog. Like
Oh no,
you're
absolutely.
okay, but your dog like she it's. She doesn't fully understand or grasp like the whole world around her, but she understands you and understands that she trusts you and stuff like that. And I think when you see an animal getting hurt or anything like that, it's always going to make you go, "No." So even a man as mighty as Caleb will see that and go, "Oh, I'm broken now on the inside."
That was it. I mean, like we were saying beforehand, you're speaking about your cat beforehand. I was speaking about my dog. I've been having internet issues all morning, and I was sh shouting at a little hub, a three hub, and she was like on her bed looking really sad and like, "What have
Yeah.
I done?" And I'm like, "You're fine." Every time I saw her, I was like, "You're fine. You're fine. You're fine."
Yeah.
Fucking hate this thing. This thing's gonna die. So
I
yeah,
think,
innocence.
yeah. I think especially when you see like Rocket's first word. So, yeah. Basically, at the start of the film, Adam Warlock comes and shoots Rocket, and Rocket is. Then they try and put a med pack on Rocket, but they find out he's got like something strapped to his heart that will kill that could like kill him. So like throughout the film, they're going to try and figure out how to get this code off, which ends up with a big journey of them locating the High Evolutionary, and there's a whole thing with about that. I won't go too deep into it because obviously you're saying we want people to go watch it, and we can't spoil a lot about it. I will be mentioning a fair whack about Rocket's past, if that's okay though, because I feel
Sorry.
like it's very obvious where that how that
Yeah.
happens, what happens with them anyway. But throughout the film, you're littered with flashbacks to Rocket. Basically being made, and well, he's like comatose, and you see him his first like time getting made. Like at the very start of the film, he you see like a higher version of the like hand reaching to a cage and grabbing like a poor little innocent raccoon who then transforms into Rocket. As you get the brilliant opening scene with Creep playing over the background, playing over the top as Rocket is like walking, going, "I'm a creep. I'm a weirdo," and then that's as much singing as you're getting from me. Fucking hell, why'd I do that? Then you get obviously the flashbacks, and Rocket is like just getting chucked in the cage when his skull's pretty much like on show. He's bleeding. His whole hands or everything has obviously been a like bio like biologically enhanced to grow in a different manner than naturally. And he his like Lila, the otter, Floor, the rabbit who looks like the thing from Toy Story, you know, like the fishing rod with like yeah, she comes out and like these terrifying creations who have like hearts of gold come out and there's like, "Are you okay?" pretty much. And Rocket's like first where this hurts. And I'm like, oh no, you've shot James. James, you've shot me. No. And then throughout that, it explores his relationship with them and his relationship with the High Evolutionary, and like the High Evolutionary's ego not allowing, like, so the High Evolutionary's whole thing is he wants to create a society that is perfect, but he can't handle it when Rocket is smarter than him. Like, basically, throughout the film, in flashbacks, the High Evolutionary is trying to figure out how to make the perfect like creature. Like, he's got this like cage that takes like a turtle through like 6 million years of evolution to turn into a human being, pretty much. But he can't work out how to make them docile because they're all mental when they turn into creatures. They're all like feral, pretty much. And Rocket, little baby Rocket, is like, "Oh, you do this, this, and that, and then they're nice and happy." And then he's like, "Say that again." And he's like, "You do this," and he's like, And then he tests it out, and it works. And then his hubris is fucked. Because then he's like, "Oh my god, this little creature is smarter than me, but no one can be smarter than the High Evolutionary." Even though his whole thing is, you made him, surely you should be happy that Rocket is smarter than you, you know? But yeah, like his like I think that's again another thing that makes the High Evolutionary a fucking fantastic villain.
There's just no redeemable qualities, and that's what you should have in a villain. I mean, you said Ronan was two dimensional, which yeah, was pretty accurate. I mean, even Ego, the just whole thing of him being a planet, and being able to change and make these things, that's pretty cool. But the High Evolutionary is just an evil bastard.
The High Evolutionary is just a despicable person, and I think his whole thing is like he wants to make he wants to mold nature and stuff around him into his image. It's why he's like when they go to the Counter Earth, it's why the Statue of Liberty is a fucking it's him. You know what I mean? Like, he wants to play God, and he says it as much near the end of the film. Where he's like, he says, "There is no God, but I'm here to take his place." And then, and I think obviously the audience despises him from the start, and especially what he does halfway through the film, where he breaks everyone's hearts, and that spoilers for anyone that hasn't watched the film, but you probably know where this is going, and kills Rocket's love Lila, and then his two friends, and then
I'm actually
he
getting
and then
sad
Rocket,
as you're
yeah.
dropping it.
And then to brighten up the mood, Rocket mauls his face. So yeah, that's great. Anyway, what Nathan Fillion's in that film as well?
Actually in it, CGI
Yeah.
in the first one, a poster in the second one, and then finally in the third one as Nathan
Finally, in the
Fillion.
third one, yes.
It did again. It was one of those where you look and go, "Oh, Nathan Fillion's finally made it in. Cool." But his interactions were like the bit of the trailer with the Among Us kind of motif, but
Yeah.
the whole thing with them being in there and speaking about having a colleague that's a bit stupid and all that kind of stuff. And you watch it, that's yes. The humor, I think all the humor in the second one, it was a bit too broad and it was trying to catch too many people and it some of it missed. I think it returned to form with volume
Yeah.
three, where all the humor hit and all the heartfelt moments
Yeah.
absolutely hit so
I
hard that
think
you're bawling in the cinema.
This film proves that it isn't like a superhero fatigue going around with the MCU. It's just a lack of good films in the MCU that is causing people to kind of driven away. And I think Marvel has missed the beat because now James Gunn, this was pretty much his farewell, this film from Marvel and the MCU. Because now he's like head creative at DC now, and he's like redoing the entire DC universe. So we'll have to wait and see how that goes. But I think Marvel missed a trick not like sending him to a longer contract to do something more. Because what he does is fucking brilliant, and it proves it with Guardians 3, because it's such an adult film as well in the sense of the themes and how it's like people finding themselves, and every character's like arc is wrapped up in such a meaningful way. Yeah, it's just a fantastic film.
And I didn't know how it was going to go with like Adam Warlock versus Will Poulter. When you obviously we see him, he goes the guy with the eyebrows, and it even he because they explained why he's the way he is. It's like you always see people banging on about him. He's the most powerful being in the world, but near the start with the Sovereign and Aisha, they said that she even said to High Evolutionary, "You've taken him
You
out and
took him
fought to
out.
her." So from that point, you can go, right, that's fine. You know, if he's going to be a bit powerful and zealous and all that kind of stuff, but he's not going to be the fully, he's not going to
Yeah.
be Adam Warlock that nerds on the internet are going to go, "Oh, but he's not." he's not this big powerful being kind of thing. So the James Gunn was very well at knowing, he knew his audience pretty much. He knew what people were probably going to moan about, and then put in lines to counter the possible criticism that would come from it.
I think with Adam Warlock as well. He's ironically enough, a lot of the comedy relief comes from him. Because he demonstrates how powerful he is. Like he beats the shit out of Nebula at the start of the film. He pretty much decapitates Groot at the start of the film. He is a, he sh it showcases how he's powerful, but how also he's so inept at stuff. Like he has some banging lines. Like they go to they do the Among Us thing where they go to the mushy space planet to find out information about Rocket. And then the Sovereign show up afterwards. Adam Warlock shows up afterwards, and like they he has they have one of the what the fuck what they called Ravengers. They have one of the Ravengers there who's got his like pet thing. And then what's his mum called again?
Aisha.
Aisha. She's like Adam. Show him we mean business. He's like, it's like zap, like disintegrates the poor man, and she turns around and is like, you're supposed to show me you're to mean business. And he's like, what business? So which could we could? Oh, what's the line? I can't remember it. No, it's like, what business could we have possibly shown him? And I'm like, yes, fantastic.
It's that is when he's when I think it's Gamora threatens. Oh, Gamora's back.
The little
Gamora
thing, yeah.
threatens Blurpee, I think it's called. Threatens Blurpee, and he goes, and he's just like, oh, hang on, let's not be rash.
Yeah. Let's not be rash now.
I destroyed all your friends and battered folk, but just leave Blurpee alone. There's limits.
It's when he just kills one of the that Ravenger, and the thing like crawls up onto his foot, and he's like, don't like how it's making me feel. Like, yeah, that's right. You feel bad.
I think I didn't know what to expect with Will Poulter as Adam Warlock, but he nailed it. He did the job that he needed to do,
The
and it
only
was
thing
great.
I had seen him in was I hadn't seen is it We're the Millers?
Yeah.
I hadn't seen him in that, but I had seen scenes with him and Jennifer Aniston. And then I think the only thing I had properly seen him in is the fucking Black Mirror Bandersnatch game. Well,
All right.
movie, whatever you want to call it. Yeah, he plays like a game designer in that. And one of the options in that game, or one of the endings, is you have him like you see him jump off a roof after he takes LSD, and he just turns on you, he's like, see you later. And he just jumps. He has this weird fucking accent as well, but he just jumps off, and then lands on a, on a, on a, on a like a bin or something like that. That's the only thing I really had of him, and he was quite skinny in that. So to see him in Guardians, real to the gills, I'm like, Jesus fucking Christ, what happened to you?
Oh, unbelievable! Because I was hearing like folk, they're kind of dream casting, and for me, if it was like an all powered Adam Warlock, I was hearing like Zac Efron. I thought, yeah, maybe he's got a good acting range, and it probably fit into that kind of film. No bother. But then I was seeing the performance of Will Poulter. I was like, yeah, okay, James Gunn, damn you and your correct
I
casting.
think James Gunn takes these weird casting decisions. Like, he's taken Batista and John Cena and like turned them like franchises pretty much around them as well. And like to be honest, right? Rock in contact with him. It seems like James has a really good track record of turning wrestlers into fantastic actors. So Dwayne, page him, take his number, do anything, please.
Listen, just listen. Tell James Gunn will tell you what to do, and then you just do it. That's the easiest way. Nobody needs a whole film franchise around you. Just
Yeah.
you can be a baddie. You can be a tree. Actually, no, you can't do that because if you have two trees in the same film, one's obviously they've got to have equal fights, and it's just a whole thing. But
My
yes.
favorite, my sorry, com to completely go off one little thing. My favorite little piece of trivia is with the Fast, back to the Fast franchise. Vin Diesel, The Rock, and I think Jason Statham have like a thing in their contract where they can't get shown being beaten in a fight. Legitimately, their contract says we're not going to put you over. So there was one scene in like one of the Fast franchises where Vin Diesel just causes an earthquake. Like he
Yeah.
stomps on the ground and a bridge like collapses, and that's how he beats Jason Statham. To save it from him physically losing a fight, he causes a fucking earthquake. I'm like, The Fast franchise is just a battle of egos, ironically enough.
It's amazing. They have to obviously look the same size and same height and everything, and one can't be bigger than the other. And Jesus Christ, grow up, guys. I mean,
And then you've got Batista, and then you've got Batista
lot of glasses.
saying lines as, "Why is Gamora?"
I know, and he's doing films where he's supposed to look like an unassuming man, so he's got little glasses, but he's still 6 foot 2 and built like a brick
Yeah.
shit house. You know, so he's trying. And
He
that's
is
all you can
trying.
ex that's all you can hope for. So yeah, Volume 3, like I said, I don't want to like spoil it too much because it is fairly fresh out, and there'll be people that have children who haven't been able to
Yeah.
organize a babysitter or what have you to get to the film. But it's a wonderful send off for James Gunn and for these characters, because that's the last of this team that as it is, because the new kind of team you see it at the end. And it was just there was lots so many callbacks as well from the previous films that really helped it, that kind of drew those emotional moments and strings. And
Yeah.
there was a bit with the bit with Drax's ending that made me cry as well, because I'm an emotional bitch now when it comes to watching movies.
No, I agree with you on that though. I think going from the destroyer to, to what he is in the end of Guardians 3, it's such a poetic ending to that character, and I think it makes so much sense for him.
Absolutely. And then of course the ending was we got to see Groot's kind of in his final form as well, and that was
Yeah.
so cool. And yeah, as a trilogy going into this, I was thinking, what's my favorite kind of trilogy of films in this Marvel universe anyway? And I love the Captain America trilogy. I try to think of otherwise, yeah, the Ant-Man one I like, but I know people don't.
I
Spider-Man trilogy.
really love the first Ant-Man. Bad villain, Yellowjack is a shitty villain, but in general, I really like the first Ant-Man because the concept's really cool, and then the other Ant-Mans are I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I don't, I like them, but I know the people don't. And of course, you got what was our trilogies? Thor. That's not a trilogy anymore, because I mean, a fourth one, so that doesn't count.
Quadrilogy.
Yeah, so it doesn't count as a trilogy. It's like Indiana Jones lost its record as being a good trilogy when it made that absolutely horrific fourth film.
Yeah.
Same with Die Hard. That dropped off after
It
after.
lost its right to being a trilogy.
Exactly. That's it. That's my thought on it. If you make a fourth film, you're no longer in the conversation for best trilogy.
Does that mean Star Wars, but then Star Wars has
It's
the original trilogy.
a saga, I would say.
Yeah, okay, fair enough.
Yeah,
I'll take
like
that.
the Fast and Furious films. It's a Fast and Furious podcast in the end. You haven't even seen them. So yeah, when coming to this, like probably Captain America ones, I would say, because I wouldn't even count the Avengers films as a continuation, because they're kind of
Yeah.
ending
They're
of
kind of like a big like ensemble, like
yeah.
all yeah, you know what I mean?
But coming out of this film, I was like, yeah, it's probably the Guardians. They've all four film all three films have been near as damn it or actually perfect films. So
Yeah.
I would say it's
As
probably
much
the trilogy.
as a shill I am for the Raimi Fran trilogy, obviously. Like we've done a whole podcast about how much I love the original like trilogy of those films. I do think that the Guardians trilogy is as close to a perfect trilogy you can probably get. All three films are something different. All three films are uninteresting to watch and have different themes and different character arcs, and it doesn't make any of the characters seem like idiots. The only thing that takes me out of it a little bit is for the first two, you don't need any background. With the with the with the third one, you need a little bit of
Context.
background information. Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, I need to quickly dip out of frame because my laptop's gonna run out of charge. So talk, Billy, talk.
Okay. So that I think we've kind of completed our trilogy of films, Guardians. I'm looking at the time. I think we've just about 2 hours, which you know, it's. I don't think we're gonna hit the record of our Scotty Swift chats, but we're pretty gonna be pretty high up there. Hopefully, everyone's watched the whole
Sure.
thing, because it helps my minutes when it comes to trying to get a partner on YouTube and maybe start earning some money. Even though I've got my Manscaped kit, there's gonna be just a little blurb thing at the audio at the start there. The adverts haven't went well, because I keep starting them with how your balls, and then they just descended to madness from that point onwards. But it's a good kit, and you still get 20% off if
How
you
many
put.
sorry, am I interrupting an ad read here, by the
No,
way?
not really. No,
Okay.
I was just trying to fill time for a minute while you were getting ready. But yeah, SWN20 at manscaped.com, and you can still get 20% off and free shipping. And it's a good kit. I enjoy it. I still use it. That's how I did my head, even though you could use it on other parts as well. But I did my head, and it looks
How I did
pretty.
my head. No, I'm not making that joke. I'm not making that joke. I'm not making that joke. No, anyway.
Oh, and you thought the bit we're using in Creep was going to be the bit that gets clipped out of this episode.
Oh God, why did I do that? Why did I do that? No,
No.
I've used Manscaped as well. I've been sponsored by them too. So we're
Yeah.
doing well, Billy. I
Good
was gonna
stuff.
ask how many watch hours do you currently have?
Oh God, hang on. I could find out. Hang on, I'll check the old app while I'm doing this. And while I'm doing that though, we do have two more questions. We've got Kirsten, who takes amazing photos at wrestling shows now.
She does fantastic photos.
Absolutely. And she asks, what do you think has been the best music feature in the Guardians of the Galaxy trilogy?
I think the one that I sung about 20 minutes ago. I like there are really good ones as well. And this is like the opening scene to the very first Guardians with sets the tone perfectly, I feel. But I also what's the name of the song that plays during Peter and Ego fighting?
The chain Fleetwood Mac.
When that plays, when Peter's like, "You shouldn't have killed my mum and squish my Walkman," and then it hits when he hits Ego. That's a really good one. But I think personally, I really love the opening to the Guardians 3, and maybe that's recency bias, but I just think that one hits really well, and obviously it tells you a lot about Rocket and how he's feeling at the time. I feel like the best choices of licensed music in Guardians is when it tells you something about the character. Especially like another one is when Peter opens the gift from his mum finally at the end of the first Guardians, and the lyrics are pretty much saying like, "Oh God, ain't no mountain high," and it's a lot of the lyrics can be recontextualized into how Peter's mum feels about Peter. It's like, if I'm not here, you can still find me. And I'm like, oh yes, or maybe I'm reading too deep into it and being a film bro. Who knows?
Well, for me, it would be coming a little bit closer with Yondu, of course, the start of Volume 2 with Mr. Blue Sky, as well, because I love that song anyway. So that helps. Right, how about watch hours? Last 365 days, just over 1,000.
Okay.
1,038.
You only need like you only need 4,000 watch hours, don't you?
Only.
Yeah.
Yes.
No. Sorry.
I've got 575 subscribers, so I'm getting
Okay,
there.
so is it still the case that you need when I hit it was you need 1,000 subscribers and 4,000 hours of watch time to be monetized. It's still the same.
Yeah, still the same.
Okay. You should hit that, and you should be able to hit that sooner or later, though, Billy.
It's
One of the episodes.
started to happen. I'm putting shorts out now, which it's just helping my numbers when it comes to.
Shorts definitely help. I need to start doing them, but I just don't know how.
I've just been taking old clips I've taken at shows and just went, I'll put that up and hope for the best. And most of the time, I get about 5K or something like that, which is fine. I'm more than
Good.
happy with that.
That's genuinely really good.
Yeah, see 5,000 people watch Lord Mr. Miles die. Well, I'll take that for my numbers.
Bro, yeah, no, it's good. It's good. Trust me.
And the last question that we've got is from Kirsten again, which I think rounds off nicely, is just ranking the three films in an order of, I assume, your favorites.
I think Bart, like this is pretty much like just say like this is pretty much saying what's your favorite pizza, like they're all good, you know what I mean. Speaking of which, I haven't ate today. I'm an athlete though, can't be having pizza. Probably gonna order pizza anyway. Think number two, volume two is free just because I didn't enjoy it as much as three and four, three and four, three and one, and I feel like it's very heavy on the CGI in that film for Ego's world and Ego's planet, and I feel like I like something, and obviously the first one's really heavy on CGI, but there are like real sets that you used, and it feels a lot more tangible and a lot more like you can grab out and touch it, you know what I mean? I'm a sucker for practical shit, so I really, but I think two, for as good as it is, it's my third favorite. It's number three. Here's the thing, these are interchangeable. I'm going to say recency bias on this, but I'm going to say probably number one is my second. Just because of it does everything right, apart from I do feel Ronan's a little bit two-dimensional. And then my top one has to be number three, just because it juggles so many different aspects so fucking well together. And I feel like maybe I've had a drought of good MCU content as of late, but this is my first time watching something going, that was fucking great. Not just saying that was a good superhero film, that's a good film. You know what I mean?
I agree with that one in three in that list, like volume one and volume three, it can be interchangeable depending on
Yeah.
kind of day. But like recency bias can, had so many feelings recently on volume three that
Yeah, it might change. It might change after like a couple of months, but who knows? I
but
really I watched like sorry, I was just gonna say I watched like recent films and like I really want to do like a video or a review on it, but then I'm like I don't have any footage, so I can't even like I have nothing to work with. I don't want to get copyright claimed, which my most recent video did. So now I'm like I don't want to, I definitely don't want to get copyright claimed again.
I was going to say, in a couple of months, it'll be on Disney Plus, and all those feelings will return again. And yeah, it'll be I think I put in my rankings of general film of all my MCU films that I've watched, and that it's I think it's top 10 again. It's I've put third, so that is quite a recency bias when I put it third.
I do
I think
have I
the
do
first
have
one's eighth.
I do have a ranking here. Hang on. I'm going my letterbox. Give me a minute.
Oof.
I've got a list of my favorite MCU yeah, my MCU ranked. Okay, at the moment, my top like five is Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. Four is Infinity War. Three is Captain America, the Winter Soldier, and then two is the first Guardians, and one is the Third Guardians.
Oh, so mine five is Thor Ragnarok. Infinity War is sixth, so it's really close. All these
Okay.
anything top 10 is just really close to each other anyway. Four is Winter Soldier, three is Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3, two is Spider-Man No Way Home, and one's Endgame.
Oh,
Just
fair enough.
for the portal scene alone.
Yeah, that's
Yeah.
valid.
So yeah, we've spoken for 2 hours about Guardians of the Galaxy and mostly about Fast and Furious as well. Somehow we ended up speaking about that a lot.
Bro, I've never seen him. Never
I
seen
know.
him once.
I don't know how that happens. So yeah, I don't know how to. This has been the third anniversary, and I think this has been just a good chat. I like doing shows with you because we're a good age apart. We're about 10 years apart, but we still have similar interests of the Marvel stuff and the wrestling stuff, and we
Yeah.
just talk about just about anything, which is fine. So the next time we'll be seeing you though will be for the Day of Birth Bonanza.
Oh,
For
God.
that
Oh,
wonderful
God.
trophy and possibly a belt if Brent decides to unleash it from his grasp if he loses. How do you fancy your chances? You see the lineup. There's eight others against you.
I've seen the lineup. As I said, I have no intention of winning the belt or the prize. I'm there for some good banter. Brent, he can keep the belt. That's a, or Omar can get it. That's all I particularly care about. I think for me, I'm just gonna go there and take this a bit. If I don't know the answer, I will give some jokey answers. Yes, that's what I'm going to do.
The Day of Earth Bonanza is the most it's the most untethered podcast, but
I
we can say so many things we probably shouldn't on podcasts.
I watched I watched. I don't know if I've already mentioned this. I watched the second one in its entirety while I was editing my last video, and Tom Atlas, right? The boy gets some stick. Because I mind I was think I was watching it and he said something where someone said it looked like he was smoking a joint because he had his like white pen in his hand. And he gets some stick, but sometimes he does it to himself. Because he sits or takes it out and goes, No, I'm training for a weightlifting competition, so I can't partake. And I'm like, what the fuck would you say that? You've given people ammunition. But yeah,
Oh.
no, I'm looking forward to it. I'll probably I'm quite reserved in a lot of situations. So I'll probably if I have anything funny to say, I will try and say it then. Oh, but it'll be a fucking train wreck. I bet you that.
Absolutely. It's going to be the worst. It's going to be the worst slash best finale of the podcast you'll ever see. But no,
Oh, yeah.
thank you
In
very
terms of brand,
much. Oh,
one more thing. One more
yeah.
thing. In terms of brand holding that belt, yeah, no, give it to Omar or Ronan, because then Ronan has another thing to add to his list of accomplishments. And I'd rather see Ronan with a belt than Brent. Let's go.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much for joining me. Do you want to plug out all your stuff if you want, or are you just quite happy just for the vibes?
I feel like if you're here, you know me from YouTube, so you already know what that is. Twitter is AlexWeb101. Instagram is AlexWeb101. The Please Give Me Money app is AlexWeb101 as well. That's Patreon, Billy. You're looking at
Ah,
me like you're confused.
so I've Patreon as well. Yay.
I currently don't have anything on there. It's more of like if you want to give back or anything like that, I'm looking to get more content on that. I'm looking to make a second channel as well where I can do like less highly intensive editing edited videos, because the ones that I currently do make me lose more of my hair the more I have to fucking stress and edit them. But yeah, that's me at the moment. Thank you for having me on. I've enjoyed this chat a lot.
There we go.
Please don't clip me singing Creep. Thank you.
I can't promise that, but thank you.